There's something about having land and sea. Never having to choose between digging in or looking out. Here, you can go where the spirit or the wind moves you. To the tops of the trees, along secluded beaches, or into more wild and scenic rivers than anywhere else in the western United States. We're the closest place to the sunset while still keeping your feet dry, and a destination where anyone can begin. We share more than we keep, so you can see more than you imagined. This is a place you have to touch, hold, and feel to believe. The entire shoreline of the West Coast's best coast is open to you, and playgrounds made of forests are waiting for you. Escape to Curry County, and don't leave anything out.
If yours is the next big idea, and you need the right place to fine-tune it, build it, launch it, if you're only your best when you can play more than you work, if inspiration comes from the outside, you belong in Curry County. The westernmost point of the land you love, and the edge between familiar and uncharted. Break the pattern. Be where the airports are as close as the beaches, and industry and recreation never cease to amaze. Dock, dive, and dine in a single day, and never lose your connection. This is the threshold of the West. Live where you can do you, and do it well, at the farthest point from ordinary. Curry County, living on the edge.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Wildfire, as everyone knows, has emerged as one of the big major issues affecting Oregon and, for that matter, all western states. A real actionable response that's including how do we fight fire, actively managing our forests so that we don't have the fuels out there, and how are we going to protect communities from smoke exposures. The council is really set up to have a comprehensive strategy that's based on action and based on protecting our communities.
The primary focus we as a board have come through with is that in researching the policies for fire management, yes, prescribed fire has its place on the landscape, but not during fire season. We, as a county, passed a proclamation that says once the state fire marshal declares fire season, it'll be nothing but full suppression, and recently took a resolution to the National Association of Counties, essentially says that they support coordination between agencies and local governments for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens regarding fire, prescribed fire, fire season, anything that affects our citizens.
This is Lily Morgan from Josephine County, and we are at the Rogue Leadership Forum today, looking at the best possible partnerships that we can come up with to fight the fire issues and the smoke issues that we're facing in Southwest Oregon. So looking forward to coming up with solutions and the partnerships to get the job done so we don't face what we have the last few years with catastrophic fires and smoke that invades our communities for months to come. So this is a good opportunity, and we hope to be successful in the outcome.
Seeing so many people come together has really been exciting for me because there's a lot of expertise, there's a lot of resources, and as we attempt to do a shared stewardship approach to keeping people safe, it's really important that we get together. So my name is Merv George Jr. and I'm the Forest Supervisor for the Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest. One of the first things is making sure to get fires out if they're threatening life and property. The second thing that I'm going to focus in on is when it's safe to do so, to put some fire on the landscape when it's cooler and not during fire season, to reduce these same fuels that are giving us so much fits during the fire season.
Bob Horton, I'm the fire chief of Jackson County Fire District 3 in Southern Oregon. The challenges that are facing us in terms of the mega fires and the wildfires that we've been experiencing out in this valley, particularly in the last couple of years, but across the state and across the region, incredibly concerning to us in the fire community, those in our communities in general, our constituents and our patrons are extremely concerned, as they ought to be. And really, the takeaway from the work that's being done now is this is an extraordinary collaboration of dozens on dozens of interested stakeholder groups who are coming together with a common purpose. It's really an inspiring showing of humanity to not only be able to provide for a greater quality of life for our people, but to be strong stewards of our land so that our future for us and generations to come is incredibly bright.
Very pressing issue. It's bearing down on us. Fire season is approaching, and I am really interested in preventing my home and other homes in my community from being impacted by wildfire, specifically from being burnt down. That's my main reason for being involved.
Quite a collaboration of folks. We're here looking for practical solutions to help us unravel some of the issues surrounding wildfires today here in the state of Oregon. And my focus really is on planning for large wildfire events in advance of their occurrence. That way, when they do occur, we can respond more appropriately to those situations.
Well, I just think it's grand of all of the people all over the state have come together today to be concerned about water. It just warms my heart because I know that they really will leave here today feeling more impressed about the water, because I have told them that we're all born in water. We cannot live without it. It's our job to take care and stop the garbage in the rivers and streams and oceans, because there's life in that water, and it's our job to keep it clean for them. Because we cannot live on this planet without the animal kingdom. I was in Ohio at the Ohio River when Dr. Emoto, the Japanese scientist who had proven water could hear, he and I stood on the riverbank and blessed the Ohio River that they had us come to do. And I prayed that God has still kept the river good for them over there. We were taught when we were little that prayer works. You too remember your prayers, because they work. It has nothing to do with religion or church.
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot. Drive to work. Take public transportation. Or experience a natural disaster in your community. Chances are, you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities, and the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways, keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
Hi there, I'm Patrick Priest, Executive Director at CIS, and I really enjoy coming every year to this conference because CIS, we are all about counties. We are owned by counties. We were formed by the AOC. This is a great occasion for us to meet everybody in one place and learn what's important to the counties all across Oregon.
It's the networking. I mean, we learn a lot about the different issues that counties deal with, but it's networking with other commissioners, getting ideas on how they handle situations that is the most helpful for me.
I love my job. It actually matters to me on a daily basis. I used to do a lot of charity, and, you know, in commissioning in Deschutes County, you can make a serious difference. Lots of things have happened since I've been in office, and I feel like it's important to represent the people. I grew up in Eastern Oregon, and I love the residents of Eastern Oregon. The architect of our first house actually had Doris Day as a dear friend and a client, and he would bring Doris Day up the mountains in Malibu to our house as it was being built.
This is my fourth conference at AOC. My favorite part is the fellowship with other commissioners and coming up with solutions with common situations and with commissioners from around the state to best serve our people. My favorite part about being a commissioner in Josephine County is the people that we work with. We live in the most beautiful place, but we have the most beautiful people. They are talented, artistic, caring. We have such a high level of philanthropy and just caring for our fellow citizens, and it's the best place in all of Oregon.
Hi, I'm Commissioner Martha Schrader from Clackamas County, Oregon. I'm the current president of the Association of Oregon Counties. Oh my goodness, I've been president for 1 year, but I've been a member of the Association of Oregon Counties since 2003. So one of the reasons I really wanted to be president and I've enjoyed it so much is because I get to know everybody across the state, all the commissioners, and I've been from one end of the state to the other, visiting with them, talking with them, and really getting an idea of how we differ, but more importantly, what our similarities are and what we can do with one another to move forward with good county government.
I've been coming to AOC now for 4 years. My favorite part of serving as commissioner is trying to bring positive effects for our community and our county.
This is my second year at AOC, and the camaraderie that I've found in my Eastern Oregon partners and just the camaraderie of AOC has really blessed my life.
My name is Court Boys, Curry County Commissioner. This is a collection of people, county commissioners, public officials, well attended from all over the state. You know, I have the privilege of working with a very diverse group of people, different ages, different backgrounds, different interests, but they're all teaming up to solve the problems of our county, and it's just really a pleasure to be able to be connected with and working with those people, and better days, good days ahead for our county and our citizens.
Hi, I'm Joe Tobolskis. This is my third AOC convention, and my favorite part is the networking with the people. And the breakout sessions are kind of good because it gives me something to focus on, a goal where I want the county to be in 5 years when my term is up.
Hi, I'm Kilmer County Commissioner Dave Yamamoto. Our county college class was probably the best county college class ever at AOC. It was the largest at over 33 members. When you look at the legislature and the power that the major metropolitan areas have, the rural counties are oftentimes left out of those conversations. AOC really does a terrific job of representing rural counties and rural interests, and we wouldn't have the impact that we do in Oregon without AOC.
My name is Joe Burney, Lane County Commissioner from Springfield. My favorite part is eating good food. My second favorite part is meeting with other commissioners, seeing what they're thinking, comparing solutions to problems, learning how nonpartisan solutions really are, and getting ideas.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Derek DeGroot, Klamath County Commissioner.
So I'm running for second vice president of the Association of Oregon Counties. I believe that our association is perfectly poised to solve problems and bring solutions to Oregon politics and communicate with the legislature about the diversity of Oregon.
I'm Jay Bozovich, and I'm a Lane County Commissioner. So I've been a commissioner for about 8 years and 11 months. And my favorite part about being a commissioner is this job is different every day.
Hi, my name is Alex Tardif, and I'm a commissioner for Columbia County and currently serving as AOC treasurer in my second year. And the thing I enjoy most about AOC and being the treasurer is the ability to bring 36 counties together to build a state vision to move our state forward into the future while building a livable, workable community that we all want to enjoy.
One of the things I really appreciate about our entire region is that we embrace who we are, and I think that's what unifies us. Once the timber and fishing industries collapsed, it took us a long time to get back on our feet. People didn't quite grasp the idea that once these jobs left, they weren't going to get other family wage jobs, and it crippled us.
Things were getting really dire. So we just saw that this was an opportunity to maybe look at that public land a little differently and how it could bring more dollars into our region.
The Wild Rivers Coast is so unique because there are more wild and scenic rivers here than anywhere else in the lower 48 states. The scenic beauty is just amazing. There's so many different places to go, from the national forest down to the protected ocean, and it's just a really special place.
I guess I didn't really know how special it was, though, until I moved away to Portland and came back and saw all the potential here.
We're uncrowded, we're unspoiled, and we're a little difficult to get to, but my God, once you come here, you fall in love.
We just thought if we could pull people to come into this Wild Rivers Coast and stay longer and explore a little farther into our backcountry, there was a lot of opportunities for them to experience.
I think our whole future is at stake here. This area is ready to go. We just need to give it a little kick in the butt.
I'm gonna be honest, when the Rural Tourism Studio came here, I was skeptical because I didn't see far enough ahead that we actually could collaborate regionally. And I'm pleasantly surprised. It's been amazing.
The Rural Tourism Studios was the first time we were able to come together as a region to talk about the future of our economy.
If we can have a strong tourism economy in this area, it's gonna benefit the whole community.
We have to rely on ourselves, and I think through this program, it sort of opened our eyes to what we could do when we work together. Community leaders really focused on three areas: outdoor recreation, food and agricultural tourism, and really building community relationships.
In our area, a lot of the food that's grown all gets shipped away. And so now we're realizing that we can capture some of that local food that's grown here. The Eat Fresh and Local Action Team has hosted a series of networking events bringing together the area growers with the area vendors so that we could have more local food available to the visitors to our area. And now we're seeing more local food in our grocery stores, in our restaurants, and we have a new local food co-op.
We created a farm trail from Bandon to Port Orford. We did 9 U-Pick farms. And it just gained traction and people loved it.
Langlois is less than 500 people. It's very small. So we have to bring in tourists. And being on the farm trail, even though it's just beginning, has really helped do that. We really want to make it a destination for anybody. My mom and I began Dragonfly Farm just 3 years ago. When I found out that I could grow a seed and turn that into food, it was like, oh my gosh, why wouldn't you do this? I just quit my day job and I just signed the paper to be an official co-owner of the farm. This is what I want to do for the rest of my life and grow with the community.
Out of the Outdoor Recreation Action Team, we came up with a series of maps that show where the best places to go recreate are. We know where we're going to send people now, and we got a great map that shows all the best places to go see.
For us to get a mapping project done to this extent is pretty impressive. We're patting ourselves on the back. I don't know anybody else's, but we're doing it.
From that, we decided that there was some places that needed help, so we came up with a mountain bike plan. And we also worked on designating a state scenic bikeway. The Outdoor Recreation Action Team was also looking at how we can make scuba diving better in this area. So we came up with the idea for a scuba fill station. So now people that want to come and dive in this area, they can dive for multiple days because they can get their tanks filled up again. When I started the Rural Tourism Studio, my business with South Coast Tours was really small. And now we've grown to about 5 or 6 guides. And we're doing tours all over from Brookings all the way up to Coos Bay.
Overall, tourism is on the rise here. We've had a bang up last 2 years, and it's like a breath of fresh air down here.
My hope for the area is that we still keep that sense of place.
Loving a place to death is a big concern that I have, and it's a balance. We're going to promote tourism, but we want to do it in a sustainable way. One of the biggest reasons that this area has been so successful since the tourism studio is the people that are involved. We have a lot of great, motivated, smart people who understand the need to promote tourism in the right way. And it's really all about the people.
When you live in a rural community like we do, from Bandon down to Brookings, and you're strapped for cash, relationships are crucial.
As a community, I think you need to come together and find out what your mission and goals are collectively. Then you can work into smaller groups, knowing that you have the backing of the whole community behind you.
As long as everybody's just super excited about it and passionate about what they're doing and they can work together, then anything's possible.
Own what you have and don't try to be something that you're not. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna take a long time. So roll up your sleeves and just dig in with an open mind.
Everything starts out small. The things that hurt us, they all start from somewhere. The words we say, the things we do, they can grow into something else. What was small and innocent can become big and sometimes scary. All it takes is one comment, one picture, one video for something to catch fire. But a big problem doesn't need a big response. Not at first. Even if we don't know what to say, the eye emoji can be that first step we take. Let's all pledge to take that first small step together and change the world in a big way. I'm a witness, and so are you.
Roadway departure fatalities are a serious and often preventable problem in the United States. The Federal Highway Administration reports that 54% of all highway fatalities are caused by drivers leaving their lane of travel. The Oregon Department of Transportation is taking a proactive approach to reduce this kind of tragedy by implementing a centerline and shoulder rumble strip program.
Rumble strips are one of the most low-cost, cost-effective countermeasures that we can apply across the system.
Rumble strips are grooved patterns on the roadway that make a rumbling sound and a physical vibration, immediately warning inattentive drivers that they're leaving their driving lane. Rumble strips allow drivers to self-correct and avoid an accident.
About 67% of fatal crashes in Oregon are road departure crashes, which are a vehicle can leave the lane to the right and hit a ditch or a rock or a tree, something like that, or cross over the center line to the left and get in a head-on collision or a sideswipe meeting type crash.
Over an 8-year period, ODOT engineers studied segments of 16 different highways and concluded that rumble strips are highly effective at reducing lane departures.
We did a before and after crash analysis to find that we have reduced head-on fatalities by 40% with the installation of centerline rumble strips.
We've been trying to find a way to deal with a problem that seems to be increasing over the last 10 or 15 years with our drivers, and that's distracted driving. And there's a lot of things that cause distracted driving. All these distractions are things that make people take their attention away from where it should be.
Comparisons between other available safety features like guardrail and concrete barriers show that shoulder and centerline rumble strips are the most cost-effective safety treatment available.
We're finding that those are very effective in trying to make sure that when you do make that mistake, it's not the last mistake you make. They help bring your attention back to the driving task and bring you back to where you should be, focusing on being in the middle of your lane and being safe.
ODOT makes a conscious effort to use a bike-friendly rumble strip design where possible and installs 12-foot bike gaps every 48 feet of rumble strip. ODOT understands that rumble strips create a noise that can be disruptive for people who live near rural highways, and we're trying to address these concerns with different approaches.
For the noise, we're looking at some new designs. We're hoping that the new design rumble strip will be just as effective at saving people from making an error and much quieter, on the order of 10 times as quiet. And we are actually going to be installing our first full set of these style of rumble strips along 205 this summer.
So we recognize that noise is a concern, but one of the things I like to tell people is whenever you hear the sound of a rumble strip, it could be the sound of the life being saved of one of your loved ones.
Rumble strips are proven to save lives. The Oregon Department of Transportation is taking the lead in implementing the sound of safety.
Driving back and forth. The old limits were set back in the 1930s and 40s and were changed very little until just recently. So now our limits are taking into account newer vehicles, a little bit more aggressive driving style. And so those limits are going up.
And going up in a big way. This is Eric Leeming, a traffic devices engineer with ODOT. He's driving an ordinary car with some extraordinary tech on board, a GPS device that records data as he maneuvers every curve in the road. Back at his office, Eric can upload the data recorded in the car, and special software determines exactly the right speed for every curve every time. Most speeds will increase by 5 to 10 miles per hour. But in some special cases, it's much higher.
The state has a deadline of 2019 from the Federal Highway Administration. But with 8,000 miles of roads to investigate and potentially thousands of signs to change, they're not wasting any time. They're getting out there right now.
Now we're going to the W113.
About 800 signs along this section.
That's a lot of signs.
It's a lot of signs. If it's a 35 mile an hour corner, you should be taking it at 35 miles an hour.
What draws you to the Oregon coast? Is it the green and blue surf on a brilliant sunny day? Or angry, boiling waves during a raging winter storm? Do you prefer quiet coves or powerful breakers churning the sand? How about sand castles? Do you come for the rising tide or the setting sun to marvel at whales gliding through the sea or flying in the sky? Reasons to travel the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway are as far-reaching as your imagination. This is a spectacular part of Oregon that traces the entire coastline along Highway 101, guiding you to the sea and away again, to coastal towns big and small, lowland marshes, and breathtaking overlooks. It's a long byway stretching from the mouth of the Columbia River to the California border, 363 miles in all, of some of the most unblemished, awe-inspiring seascapes you'll find anywhere. In addition to its designation as a scenic byway, Highway 101 in Oregon also has been selected as an all-American road. That means when you come here, you will experience one of only 31 roads considered to be the best of the best in America.
You know, when people come to the Oregon coast, they're really astonished how beautiful it is. And what separates it from many of the other places in North America that are coastal is how undeveloped it is. And that's because Oregon had a very far-sighted land use program back in the 1970s. We have all these wonderful state parks along the scenic byway that are perfect places to stop and enjoy nature in a relatively unspoiled way.
From the north, you begin in Astoria, the first permanent European settlement in the Pacific Northwest. It's a genuine maritime community with ship traffic from around the world seeking harbor up the Columbia. The official State Maritime Museum of Oregon sits here on the river. Beautiful Victorian houses dot the hillside. And standing 600 feet above sea level is the 125-foot Astoria Column. It features a hand-painted spiral frieze that would stretch over 500 feet if unwound. Heading south, you'll find the community of Seaside, a popular vacation spot that offers miles of public beaches, an oceanfront promenade, and a downtown core packed with restaurants, shops, and even a beach-type arcade. Cannon Beach is home to one of Oregon's most photographed natural wonders, Haystack Rock. Get your shots from the beach or take a short drive up to Ecola State Park and look down on this 235-foot work of art. The picturesque small town is filled with art galleries, shops, and cafes. Ready for more? 10 miles to the south, this is the view from Cape Falcon. You're 700 feet above the Pacific. Here, the Pacific Coast Byway has been carved out of Neocone Mountain and held in place by stone walls built in the 1930s by craftsmen in the Civilian Conservation Corps. Upon descending the mountain, the highway drifts inward around Tillamook Bay to Tillamook, the unofficial dairy capital of Oregon. The verdant valley of dairy farms in this area produces 25 million gallons of milk annually. Much of that is processed into natural cheddar cheese. And near more than 800 miles of navigable waters, Tillamook is a crossroads for North Coast recreation. From here, you owe it to yourself to veer off Highway 101 to explore the Three Capes Scenic Loop. This drive places you right at the beach, beginning with Cape Mears, home to the shortest lighthouse in Oregon. 9 lighthouses stand sentinel along Oregon's coastline. They're monuments to our maritime heritage, towering links to the past, and as much a part of the rugged Oregon coastal landscape as any offshore monolith. The Cape Mears Lighthouse was first illuminated in 1890. Oregon's oldest lighthouse is at Cape Blanco, the westernmost point in the state. It was commissioned in 1870 to aid shipping generated by gold mining and the lumber industry. The 93-foot-high Yaquina Head Lighthouse is the tallest in Oregon. Today, its automated light continues to aid navigation at the entrance to Yaquina Bay. Many of the lighthouses are open to the public. Most happen to be excellent places to view nesting seabirds and offshore sea life. Tide pools, those rocky areas between high and low tides, support unique and diverse plants and animals. Vast amounts of colorful, otherworldly creatures wait to be discovered. But walk cautiously. These organisms are tough enough to withstand the pounding surf, but are utterly vulnerable to human activity. Wildlife and sea life abound on the coast.
There are 6 national wildlife refuges along the Oregon coast. The Pacific Coast Scenic Byway bisects these refuges or goes alongside them. It provides you the opportunity to see a wide variety of abundant wildlife, including seabirds, seals and sea lions, deer and elk, and many other wildlife.
Cape Kiwanda lies at the southern end of the Three Capes Scenic Loop near the town of Pacific City. Here you'll find a second haystack rock on the byway. Hike up the dune to marvel at stunning views of sandstone formations as they turn yellow, gold, or even red in the changing sunlight. If your timing is right, you'll spot one or two of the dory fleet sprint onto the beach after a day of fishing. How's this for a dinner setting? Restaurants along the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway accommodate just about any taste. Many serve an ocean view with every meal. Up and down the coast, you'll find seafood, of course, but don't limit yourself just because you're by the water. The Central Coast begins around Lincoln City, which is one of the larger communities on the byway. It has a reputation for being windy and was recognized by Kite Lines magazine as the best place to fly a kite in North America. It was incorporated from several small towns and, as a result, offers a sandy beach that is 7.5 miles long. A number of small state parks lie nestled along the ocean between Lincoln City and Newport. Stop, get out of your car, and take in the commanding views that are there, right next to your all-American road. Depot Bay boasts the world's smallest navigable harbor, 6 square acres in all. A seawall runs the length of the downtown, so everywhere you go, you're rewarded with a dramatic view of the Pacific. It's considered Oregon's whale-watching capital, with thousands making their way past Oregon each fall and spring. Fishing and whale watching excursions regularly set sail from this little harbor. Leaving Depot Bay, you'll soon find yourself at Cape Foulweather, a basalt outcropping that looms 500 feet above the water. It was here, in 1778, British Captain James Cook first sighted the mainland of North America on the Pacific coast. A fierce storm that almost put an end to his expedition earned this rugged stretch of coastline its name. Coastal weather can change by the hour. You will find a lot of wet days, but rain can become blue sky with white clouds in an afternoon. Mist kissing the headlands burns away, or storms can last for days. Some people come for those storms. Whether you find sunbursts of happiness or cloud cover like a quilt, there's always a reason to come back. Like Lincoln City, Newport is one of the larger towns on the byway. The historic bayfront on the north side of Yaquina Bay hosts one of Oregon's largest commercial fishing fleets. It has a busy, genuine working waterfront feel, with fish plants and boats coming and going from as far away as Alaska. On the south side of the bay is the Oregon Coast Aquarium. Share waters beneath the ocean with sharks and rays, and don't miss the sea otters at mealtime.
Now, all four of our otters were rescued otters. They were found out in the wild.
For the next 50 miles, your trip along Highway 101 hugs the coast. Many more state parks offer opportunities to stop and take in outstanding vistas, crashing waves, and offshore rock formations. Two small towns of note are Waldport and Yahats. Waldport sits on Alsea Bay, where fishing, clamming, and crabbing are popular. The 40-mile stretch south of Waldport marks steep headlands, jagged volcanic outcrops, and jaw-dropping scenery, the rugged edge of the Oregon coast. Yahats is a quiet, unhurried artist town just a couple of miles north of Cape Perpetua. Drive to the top of this bluff, and you'll be 800 feet above the water. On a clear day, you can see 70 miles of Oregon coastline. Drive past Hasita Head Lighthouse to the Sea Lion Caves. A quick elevator ride 200 feet down puts you in America's largest sea cave, the year-round home of wild stellar sea lions. Rugged cliffs give way to graceful beaches as you approach Florence. In the spring, be on the lookout for wild rhododendrons along the roadsides. Similar to Newport, you'll find an historic Old Town commercial district along the Siuslaw River. Florence is the gateway to the Oregon Dunes National Recreation Area. A 47-mile sandbox of wind-sculpted sand dunes towering 500 feet above sea level. These are the largest expanse of coastal sand dunes in North America. Reedsport is at the center of the Oregon Dunes, but you can do more than ride a dune buggy or motorcycle. A short 3 miles east of town on Highway 38, more than 100 Roosevelt elk reside at the Dean Creek Elk Viewing Area. Early mornings or just before dusk are the best times to photograph the herd. Paying homage to Oregon's timber heritage, Reedsport hosts an annual chainsaw sculpting championship, a time to watch three-dimensional artwork come to life right before your eyes. Mountains of sand continue at Winchester Bay. You'll also find an active marina here. It's a great place to try your hand at crabbing or take a charter for salmon or bottom fishing. The dunes end and you enter the coast's largest urban area at Coos Bay. It has the deepest natural harbor between Seattle and San Francisco. Foreign vessels sail under the massive McCullough Bridge. You may have noticed, dotted along the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway are many beautiful and iconic bridges. The Megler Bridge in Astoria, Yaquina Bay Bridge in Newport, Alsea Bay Bridge in Waldport, Siuslaw River Bridge in Florence, and the magnificent McCullough Bridge in Coos Bay are works of art in their own right. Charleston is slightly off the byway at the mouth of the bay. It was once an old waterfront fishing village and has become a commercial and sport fishing center. From here, the Charleston to Bandon tour route offers another side trip off the byway. It's a wonderful way to explore a variety of natural Pacific Coast beauty in a number of settings: beaches, vistas, gardens, and more. Giant sea stacks, a tiny lighthouse, and an old town await you in Bandon. Do you like to golf? This remote area on the Oregon coast has not one, but three of the most stunning and challenging golf courses in the world. As you drive south of town, look for brilliant red bogs in the fall. You're passing through the cranberry capital of Oregon. After a trek through forests and farmlands, you'll reach Port Orford. The wild coast has begun. You're in the most westerly city in the continental United States, and you've reached some of the most awesome scenery on the byway. Here you can watch a fishing fleet launched by crane in one of only six dolly ports in the world. Port Orford covers less than 2 square miles. It's similar to many communities that call this all-American road home. Small in size, still with a lot to offer. like Manzanita, with a vibrant business district and beautiful setting at the base of Neocone Mountain. You can board a fishing charter out of Garibaldi, swim in freshwater lakes near Dune City, catch world-class windsurfing at Pistol River. There's little development from Port Orford to Gold Beach, outlet for the renowned Rogue River. Feel like going for a ride? Jet boat excursions run from May into October up this wild and scenic river. Or maybe a midday walk on an uncrowded beach is more your speed. The last dozen miles of the Pacific Coast Byway leading into Brookings save some of the best for last. Treat yourself to frequent stops along the Samuel H. Boardman Scenic Corridor. Short hikes reward you with the best views in this shining stretch of coastline. Walk, relax, and be amazed along the coves in the crashing surf. The world's northernmost redwood grove is 8 miles from the mouth of the Chetco River in Brookings. So, you've toured nature's finest art museum. You've dined elegantly, hung out with sea lions, unwound like you wish you could every day. What else is there to do? Step back in history near Astoria. Ride a horse along the waves near Florence. Pet a baby tiger near Bandon. Hike a trail, sample gourmet cheese, eat fresh caught crab, watch a sunset.
When you come to the Oregon coast and walk on the beaches or go to the headlands and go to the small coastal towns, you really can commune with nature and you don't have huge numbers of people, but you're also able to take in one of America's last great unspoiled seascapes.
So what draws you to the Oregon coast? What favorite places lure you back again and again? Each visit is different. The ocean, the sky, the light, and the experience always continue to amaze. Shouldn't you be there?
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot, drive to work, take public transportation, or experience a natural disaster in your community, chances are you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities. And the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways, keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
Well, we're here with Commissioner Colleen Roberts. for the monthly meeting of the ONC board, which Colleen sits on. Colleen, why don't you tell our audience a little bit about your mission and what you guys discuss at these monthly meetings?
Sure. Well, our ONC board is of the 18 counties in Oregon that are part of the ONC lands on their BLM. Federal lands. And we discuss everything about these lands. The ONC Act of 1937 is our primary focus, how the decisions that these lands get managed, do they match up with the congressional mandate of the ONC Act, and how we can better educate and help administer the care of these lands for the health and safety and welfare of the citizens that we represent.
I would imagine you discuss things like how many board feet can be taken out of the forest in different areas. Are these things that come up each month?
Yes. Well, harvest timber management is a big part of our conversation, as is lately the fire issues.
We're here today with Commissioner Dan DeYoung of Josephine County. Dan, you have an important role on the ONC Lands Board. And we're here in beautiful Gold Beach, Oregon, discussing the monthly matters of ONC. What was your main focus at this meeting?
Today we had a really good sit down with two representatives from the BLM. And there's constant, we work with BLM because actually the ONC lands are on BLM lands, and that's our concern. Mainly the ONC board of directors, which is a membership from all 18 counties. We always meet, I think it's bi-monthly, and then we have an annual meeting, and it's basically discuss what the sign says, forest health, jobs, and county services, that the money coming from the sale of timber on ONC lands goes through the federal government. They take their share out of it and then return it back to the counties to be used for basically jobs, county services, a lot of county services, such as law enforcement, schools. There's just an awful lot of things that these individual counties can use the money for. But it's from the sale of timber on the ONC lands. ONC lands goes way back to 1937 with the ONC, 1937 ONC Congressional Act, and the ONC Act of 1937. We're just trying to get back to the actual verbiage and the language that's in that act. It's surprising to us how we can ignore a congressional act. That remains to be answered by the federal government, but that's what we want to get back to.
Hi there. I'm Tillamook County Commissioner Dave Yamamoto. I'm a member of the ONC Board and also the chair of the Council of Forest Trust Land Counties. And in Tillamook County, it's very important that we consider natural resource-based economies. So in Tillamook County, we have lots of dairy. I'm sure you're familiar with Tillamook Creamery, but also
great
lots
cheese.
Of state and federal timberlands. When it comes to federal timberlands in particular, everyone thinks that we're looking at timber revenue, and that's very important. But one side of the coin that people don't consider are the family wage jobs that come with all timber. It's not just the timber receipts that we get. These are family wage jobs. These are fully benefited jobs. Whereas on the tourism side, the income is about a third of what we would consider a family wage job. And there are also no benefits with those. So timber receipts are very important, but it's the family wage jobs that they create at the same time, which are very important to counties like Tillamook.
Perfect. Keeping it real for families in
Absolutely.
Tillamook County.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Yamamoto.
Thank you very much.
All right. We are here with County Commissioner Bob Main from Coos County, Oregon. And we've had the monthly meeting of ONC Lands here. And Mr. Main, Commissioner Main, I should say, tell us what your role is, Bob, on the ONC Lands Board.
I am the Vice President of the ONC Association of Oregon City Counties.
Okay.
Consists of 18 ONC counties, Western Oregon counties.
Okay.
And we make sure that the counties receive their payments from those ONC lands that Congress designated for the sole purpose of those 18 ONC counties. For no other reason, Congress decided that when they took back the lands and took them off the tax roll, that the county should benefit from the harvest of those lands. Without that, the tax rates, like in my county, would be 2 to 3 times higher.
Oh, okay. So mm-hmm. you help keep the tax rates down in your county by utilizing
sure.
the full function of this congressional
Absolutely.
Act.
Absolutely.
Okay, wonderful.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Thank you. We are here with Oregon Curry County Commissioner Court Boyce. Thank you so much for taking a moment to speak with us.
Well, thank you. With the natural resource base that this state has, I've spent better than half of my time as a county commissioner on those issues: fire management, public lands management, certainly natural resources, all of those. And so I'm often reminded that 250 years ago, the generations that came before us, when they got here to Oregon, include Northern California, they found the greatest forest in all of North America, that produce the greatest watersheds, that produce the most pristine rivers, that give us the most the highest quality of salmon or steelhead runs, arguably on the planet.
Just picked her up. We should be there in 20 minutes.
Who is it? Oh, it's him. Where is he?
I know. Yeah, I know.
I love walking. It's what I do. So who better to share some tips to help keep your walk safe? Wait for the signal. Take in the sights and smells till you get the go-ahead to cross. Use intersections to cross, but when you can't, remember your training. Always look left, right, left. Show you want to cross and wait for all lanes of traffic to stop. And make eye contact so you know the driver sees you. Hi there. Good human. You get a treat when we get home.
How many letters?
Five letters.
Just think about what am I doing right now? Smile.
Smile?
Uh-huh.
This is so easy.
My name is Judy Miles, and I'm the program director for Ready, Set, Learn. Ready, Set, Learn is a program that Carol Hackerl and I developed several years ago, coming from a site council meeting at our local school district. We were problem solving, something we could do to just help students have a better transition into the school system from the community and from their preschool classrooms. So Ready, Set, Learn was developed, and the focus of it is for children to just have an opportunity to come to the place that they'll be going to school and get comfortable with the setting. They get to have lunch and breakfast in the cafeteria and see how it works and how food is going to occur in their school. They also get to see the classrooms and meet some of the staff that they'll be seeing at the school when they start kindergarten in the fall. We provide transportation for them so that the students who live a further distance away still have access to the program and can still come and attend. And they also get to ride the school bus and find out what that is like when they're going to start school the following fall.
I'm Carol Hackerl, and I've worked with the Ready, Set, Learn program for 4 years. I started it with Judy Miles in response to recognizing that a lot of kids come into kindergarten without a whole lot of familiarity with what the K-12 school is like. We came up with the idea for this program and worked with the superintendent at that time to build something that was available to the community at no charge, to come in, have a chance to practice school skills, get familiar with school staff and school routines, keep the chance to keep learning over the summer and get ready so that when you come into school, you are comfortable and familiar and happy with your surroundings and the teachers and the chance to learn. We're open to any child in the grades that we serve, which right now is K-3, and we have a lot of children coming from Bandon as well as from the local community. During the Ready, Set, Learn program, kids come in and we start the day with a breakfast, free breakfast. And then they come into the classroom and spend a little time together as a community and during circle time. And then they rotate through a series of activities, which are all designed to be fun and engaging for them and to help them get some learning, solidify some learning that will give them a leg up on the next school year.
America's 3,069 county governments provide fundamental services for building healthy, safe, and vibrant communities. We are an intergovernmental partner, implementing federal and state policies at the local level, often under strict rules and funding constraints. County governments, through the National Association of Counties, engage federal policymakers on a range of issues like transportation, infrastructure, healthcare, public safety, and public lands management. All of these issues are vital to our nation's quality of life and our long-term prosperity. Decisions made by the White House, Congress, and federal courts have a major cascading impact on our ability to lead our communities and pursue a better future. Let's look at why federal policies matter to county government and why county government matters to America. Counties provide vital services that keep our communities thriving and secure. We own and maintain 45% of roads and 4 out of 10 bridges. We own more than a third of the airports and hundreds of hospitals and thousands of courthouses, jails, 911 call centers, and libraries. We play a critical role during emergencies like hurricanes, floods, and snowstorms. What if you called 911 and no one answered? What if you couldn't reach your medical facility because roads and bridges were in disrepair or never built? County governments are an indispensable part of the infrastructure and services that keep residents safe and connected. But with very limited revenue options under most state constitutions and laws, counties must make every penny count in order to fulfill federal and state mandates and required responsibilities. Nothing is more basic in our society than essential public facilities like schools, hospitals, airports, jails, bridges, and other infrastructure. Yet proposals have surfaced to eliminate or scale back tax-exempt municipal bonds. For over a century, municipal bonds have been the lifeblood for our nation's public infrastructure, helping finance more than $3.7 trillion in essential projects. If tax-exempt municipal bonds were eliminated or scaled back, county governments and our residents would face billions in new costs when financing vital facilities. Additionally, counties rely on MAP 21 and the Federal Highway Trust Fund to complement local transportation financing resources. With growing demands and mounting costs, we need a reliable federal partner to invest with us in our nation's economic growth and competitiveness. We need a long-term legislative solution with increased funding to ensure continued success in operating our nation's transportation system. Counties face further revenue losses each year because billions of dollars in e-commerce sales tax revenue isn't collected. The Marketplace Fairness Act would enable states and localities to collect existing, already owed taxes. It would also level the playing field between many internet retailers who don't collect sales taxes and Main Street businesses that do. County governments provide support services to federal public lands, touching 700 million annual visitors. We lead search and rescue operations, fight fires, protect the public's health, and maintain roads. Federal lands cover nearly one-third of the U.S. and impact 69% of counties. Because federal land is exempt from local property taxes, counties depend on PILT, the Payment in Lieu of Taxes program, to provide essential services. The Secure Rural Schools program provides assistance to rural counties and school districts affected by the decline in revenue from timber harvests on federal land. Decisions to cut or delay funding both programs undermine our ability to provide services and maintain public lands. Our intergovernmental partnerships don't end with legislation, because counties also implement and comply with federal and state regulations. When considering environmental protections, we know our communities and care deeply about the environment. We need a stronger voice in shaping common sense regulations that protect communities while also promoting economic growth. This is why NACO secured significant improvements to FEMA's flood insurance program and is pushing back on the waters of the U.S. proposed rule. Our message: federal policies matter to county government, and county government matters to America. Every level of government must work together to shape policies that improve the quality of life for all Americans. Whether it's building and maintaining infrastructure, providing essential services, or fostering economic growth, counties are on the front line serving their citizens. NACO stands ready to work with the administration and Congress to make our nation's communities healthier, safer, and more vibrant places to live and work.
Did I see Allison at lunch today? I'm gonna text Allison.
Hey, hold up, Matt's calling me.
Hey, we got the food and we're on our way right now. Hey, who's coming, bro?
Counties matter. Counties serve nearly every American every day. Urban, suburban, and rural, counties work with states, the federal government, and other public and private partners to keep our communities healthy, vibrant, and safe. Whether you're commuting to work or shipping goods around the globe, counties matter. Counties own and maintain 45% of the nation's roads and 4 out of 10 bridges. And we're involved in nearly a third of public airports and transit systems. Counties matter when Americans need us the most. Counties matter because we support smart, fair, and effective criminal justice systems. We help fund police and sheriff's departments. We own and operate local jails, 911 call centers, and mental health facilities. Counties create healthy communities. We invest more than $80 billion in hospitals and medical services each year. Counties matter because we invest in the lives of residents of all ages, improving their quality of life where they live and work. Counties are the building blocks of state, regional, and national economies. We support housing, recreation, and economic development. And we do so much more. From issuing birth certificates to administering elections, counties employ more than 3.5 million people. In total, we invest more than $500 billion in our residents and our communities every year. Counties provide essential services we all depend on every day. That's why counties matter.
When a large forest fire breaks out, potentially threatening lives, homes, wildlife, and thousands of acres of forest land, the news coverage is immediate and consistent. Interviews with homeowners, firefighters, medical aid providers, and others continues nonstop until the fire is sufficiently contained. At that point, the cameras are turned off, the interviews are over, and it's on to the next event. The images of catastrophic wildfire, with its ferocity and devastating impact on the land, hold the interest and attention of the public. However, there is an equally important story occurring on that same landscape after the fire is contained mopped up, and finally declared out that the public seldom sees. The frequency and size of these mega fires on federal forest land has increased significantly over the last few decades. All too often, what is left in their wake is a vast sea of dead, charred trees. Unfortunately, because of a maze of confusing and often contradictory rules and regulations, very little rehabilitation or reforestation occurs after these fires. The result of this neglect in many cases is as devastating as the fire itself. Here's why. Even in the hottest, severe fires, most of the dead trees remain standing, the wood not damaged by the fire, still suitable and valuable for lumber. But as the insects move in, within months, the dead and dying trees begin to deteriorate and decompose. Eventually, all of the economic value is lost. What is not removed will decay, add fuel to an even greater future fire threat, and in the process, release the greenhouse gases that the trees gathered and stored during the
in-stream water rights presentation. Planning Director Becky Crockett, thank you. Welcome all.
Thank you. So can you folks on the screen, can you hear me?
Thumbs up?
Yes.
Yes, great. Okay, yeah. So what I'd like to do is have you, Jake, introduce the people that are on the screen and then give it back to me. And I'm going to say a few words before we get started and identify some of the key issues and questions that have come up here in Curry County that hopefully you guys can cover in the context of your presentation, okay?
That sounds great. So thanks for making time in the agenda today for us, commissioners. And Becky, thank you for coordinating this. My name is Jake Johnstone. I am not Jake from State Farm, although there's a likeness. I am the Southwest Region Manager covering Jackson, Josephine, Coos, Curry, and Douglas County. On the line with me is Ivan Gall of Oregon Water Resource Department. He is the Field Services Administrator out of the Salem office. Also, Ann Hayden Lesmeister of ODF&W is the In-Stream Flow Coordinator, and Adrian Averitt of ODF&W, as well as Annette Fossera of ODF&W is the Policy Analyst. If I messed up on any of the introductions, folks, by all means, later when we get to presentations, maybe you can correct me. So I'll turn it back over to Becky.
Okay, thanks so much, Jake. The one thing I wanted to say before we get too far along the way is I have a lot of concerns about these in-stream rights that have been proposed, but I want to make it clear that Curry County has especially appreciated the staff that you guys have here in the county to help us, especially Scott Cicilline, Ryan Carr from Water Resources, and then Steve Mazur and Laura Green from ODFW. I can't tell you every other day how often we have some pretty difficult issues to deal with, and your people have been awesome, just awesome. So I wanna say that before we get started here. So in regards to comments on the in-stream water rights, like land use, water rights is an issue set forth in state law, yet implementation really is dictated by historical use and case law. It's difficult. It's really difficult. Difficult for people to understand, and I appreciate the difficulty in staff trying to work with people to get through the process. I'm not an expert in water rights. The issues that I've raised come from the Farm Bureau attorney, Marianne Cooper, who is a recognized attorney in the state of Oregon on a lot of legislative issues that have environmental impacts for farming, and issues that we face downstairs. And I'm really hopeful that with today's presentation, we can all get a better understanding of what's being proposed and what the impact potentially can be on the residents in Curry County. Essentially, ODFW has filed for in-stream water rights on several stream reaches in Curry County, including the main stem Chetco and the main stem Windchuck. The proposed applications will have a significant impact on farmers, as well as almost anyone trying to drill a well within a half mile of one of these reaches of the river. We believe the proposed in-stream water rights will cause injury to the public by preventing future development and will negatively impact economic opportunities in this region. And each week, we're faced with not being able to issue a planning clearance downstairs for a building because the owner or the applicant either has water but always failed to get a water right for the water that they're using, or they bought buildable land, quote unquote, with no water rights. And currently, when we're working with these folks, we call the water master and get them involved. And usually people can get water rights because Curry County is not over-appropriated for water. This will likely change with ODFW's request, causing a lot of these people not to be able to achieve water on their private property after they have made significant financial contributions to have that property. In the second page of the memo that I'm looking at, I've identified some questions or issues for discussion with these experts that we have on the stream, or on the screen, excuse me. And I think that the key issues, first of all, are having a better understanding of what the justification is for the proposed in-stream water rights that are being requested. And plus, I'd like us to understand the specific injury and supporting documentation to fish that would result from not having these in-stream rights proposed. I think it's important to understand the justification for the proposed limitations on in-stream water rights, what they would pose for future development and impacts to Curry County. And we need to understand the process, which is very difficult for most people to understand. How do we object if we want to object? And then a couple of key issues that have come up just later today is there was a notification sent to Curry County, and that was in your packet. That notification didn't include streams on the Rogue Basin, which I was confused about because several of those are in Curry County. So I would have to ask Water Resources, are the proposed streams on the Rogue Basin in Curry County still proposed, or are they taken off the list? And why didn't we get notification for those? And if we didn't get notification, is there a requirement for re-notification for those streams? And then a question on the Chetco River specifically, was the City of Brookings notified since that's their main water source on the Chetco River? So those are just some of the questions that I put out there. And with that, I'm going to let the agencies be able to address the issue and answer those questions, I hope. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Becky and Board Commissioners. Can you guys hear me all right?
Yes, sir.
Very good.
Okay. I would like to share a presentation I have here. I have shared it with you guys in PDF format. According to the GoToMeeting here, I would need to be made a presenter to have the ability to share my screen with you. So I'm not sure who the wizard is in the room, but
we got one.
She is on her way.
Help us, Mr. Wizard.
I will address quickly, though, the question regarding... Oh. Okay. Can you still hear me?
Yep. Thank you.
Okay. I will address quickly, though, while I get things set up here, the question regarding the Rogue Basin. In this presentation, I'm going to explain how there we go. Sure. Okay. I'm getting a bunch of screens here. I'm almost there. So can you folks see the slide here, in-stream water right application process?
Just popped up. Thank you.
Awesome. Great. So briefly to address that Rogue question, through this presentation, I'm going to explain how the process is for these applications. And in that, there's the water availability basin. So when I get to that slide, if I steamroll past it, please poke me, and I'll explain a little more further why you haven't been notified for some and notified for others. So. Again, Jake Johnstone, WRD, Ivan Gall, WRD on the line. I'm going to try and move through these slides relatively quickly. I know Ann and ODF&W have a few slides they'd like to share, and I think that discussion is going to be the more robust part of this conversation anyway. So, again, stop me if you have a question. Let's see. can get the sleds to move. There we go. All right. So today's discussion is going to be about in-stream water rights, just kind of explaining the history behind those, the statutory authority and the rule authority there, how we estimate natural stream flow, how we evaluate the requests for new in-streams, the impact those in-stream water rights have to water availability and future allocation, and the water right application process, which Becky alluded to being rather complex, and I hope to try and explain it a little bit for you. So the in-stream water rights, it's 1987 legislative concept called in-stream a beneficial use. So it made it something that could be allocated for water rights. Chapter 690, Division 77 goes into laying out the framework for that, implements in-stream water rights in the law, the equitable allocation and established management objectives. Can be filed for by state agencies, Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife, Oregon Parks and Recreation, and Department of Environmental Quality. Out-of-stream uses shall not factor in when determining the amount of in-stream water right. I'll go into that a little more further through the slides here. In-stream water right amounts shall not exceed the estimated natural flow. And the take-home here for this is that OWRD evaluates in-stream water rights based on the natural stream flow, not water available in the water availability, the WAR system, the water availability reporting system, sorry. So to continue along that, 690.077, Division 77 has a subsection 6 there, and I think this can help kind of explain things for folks. I've heard folks worried about their current water rights. The in-stream water rights do not take away or impair any legally established right to use the water, having an earlier priority date than the in-stream right. The underline is me there, just trying to explain that. So an in-stream granted today will not affect a older senior water right. An in-stream water right is treated like another water right when it comes to that prior appropriation doctrine. So first in time, first in line. In-stream water rights are also identified as a priority for the public benefit in the 2017 Integrated Water Resource Strategy. I know that Ann has a slide on this and maybe go able to go into this a little bit more in detail, but ultimately it was a multi-agency public outreach document that was put together through meetings and trying to understand the in-stream and out-of-stream needs for both Oregon as we move forward with development, commerce, and fishing industry. So natural stream flow estimations for our department. The OWRD standard is new in-stream water rights are less than or equal to the natural median stream flow. The median natural stream flow has been estimated for a little over 2,300 basins. And the department put out a document in 2002, this Cooper study here, which helped develop, using long-term stream gauge data and regional regression, how to define water availability in different basins throughout the state. So what does that look like in practice? So here's an example. So evaluating the requested amount, this is Winchester Creek at the mouth. The blue line is the 50% natural stream flow, so that's your median stream flow. In that WAB, which you'll see WAB a lot, we're government, we love our acronyms, but WAB is just water availability basin. And the requested in-stream water right is the yellow line, and I apologize if that's a little difficult to see, but that is what's requested in the application. The red line you can see is fitting a little bit more to that blue line, and so it's a little less here in the month of April than what was requested based off of the model that tells us what water is available at that 50% exceedance.
Hey, Jake?
Yes, sir.
Hey, for the record, folks, this is Ivan Gall here in Salem with the Water Resources Department. I just wanted to point out a couple things on this plot. Number one, our water availability calculations for the state of Oregon, and when we calculate these natural stream flow values, those are done on a monthly basis. So each month of the calendar year has a separate value, unless the value is the same for consecutive months there. So I wanted to point that out. Another way of looking at the median stream flow or natural stream flow is based on the best available information, in this case for Winchester Creek at the mouth, the median flow is basically like saying, hey, 5 out of 10 years, we would expect roughly, in this pace between 45 and 50 cubic feet per second to be available during the month of February. And that's just another way to kind of put that in your minds. So I'll stop there, Jake.
Yeah, thanks, Bob. So evaluating the requested amount, this is the slide I was referring to earlier to Becky's question regarding notification. So there are 158 new in-stream water right applications submitted in the Rogue, Umpqua, and South Coast on November 30th. They're going to be evaluated whether hydraulically correct basins, calculated meeting flows exist for each in-stream water right application. What that means is through that application process, in order for them to get their initial review, which activates the public comment, which activated the email from Mr. Kohanic to you, is they would have to have a WAB in place, so an already established water availability basin. I've highlighted the number 100 here because 100 of those do, in fact, already have a water, a model that can use the water availability basin. There are 58 that do not. So you can see that there are a number without WABs in the Rogue Basin. And I'm happy to circle back with Mr. Kohanic and make sure that he didn't do anything in error here, but my understanding, the reason you didn't get a notification specific to those was because they're still working on the model for those. Some of these in the Rogue Basin are in Jackson County and Josephine County, and as you well know, the South Coast has a significant number, but the Umpqua is carrying the larger load here with the majority of the in-stream. So this is kind of an idea of what the modelers are looking at when they talk about a nested WAB. So this is a ODS and W in-stream on a Williams Creek, which is a tributary to the North Umpqua. And so when our modeling folks are looking at it, they're looking at how this water is available in that sub-basin, but also looking at the broader picture of how much water is available down system. There are a lot of complexities in that, and some of those are some of that is why it takes so much more time for the ones that don't already have a model in place. So what's the impact of water availability? Once the application receives the initial review, the in-stream water right data are entered into WARS, which is our water availability system. In-stream water right monthly values are subtracted from water availability, and water available equals natural stream flow minus consumptive use minus the in-stream requirement. So the in-stream water rights from new watersheds that were delineated are added to WARS into their larger WAB. So those are the situations where they have to create a WAB and then nest it into the larger picture of water available in the system. So the application process, and I promise I only have four more slides, so I'll get through them as quickly as I can here. The application review process is laid out in OAR 690-310. That's general guidance on how we process water right applications. And 690 Division 77, which is more specific to the in-stream process. The process is similar to any other application. Again, we have the different steps that it moves through. And in-stream water rights can be filed by other state agencies, such as DEQ, ODF&W, and Oregon Parks. So the application is filed, the completeness, determination, and flow evaluation is done, and then you receive an initial review. In this case, 100 of those were done on January 19th, yesterday. That began the public comment process. Comments are reviewed, which may take some time. I encourage folks to start the conversation. This is that opportunity to submit some formal comments and begin the discussion of what your concerns may be. And then there's the proposed final order after the comments are addressed, and that starts a 45-day protest period, which is another option for folks who are, you know, have concerns with a specific water right. And I'll go into that a little more in detail in the next slide. So if a protest is filed, a settlement will be explored with the parties, in this case the applicant and those who filed the protest. If we can't reach an agreement, a contested case hearing may be necessary to get a final order and possibly a certificate. If a settlement is reached, most likely a certificate is issued with the final order. And if there is no protest within the 45-day period, a final order, including the certificate, is issued. I have a question slide here, but I would also like to give Anne the opportunity to go through her presentation if the Board of Commissioners feels that that would be the proper process here. And then I have shared this with Ms. Crockett, but I also have some useful links, including where to see public notice and where to submit comments.
That path will be fine, thank you. Agreed?
Yeah. Okay. So if your IT wizard would be willing to make Ann Hayden Lesmeister the presenter,
Eric?
It would be greatly appreciated. And
we're going to set you up a guest, sir. Good volume, thank you.
Great. Okay. All right. Just a moment here. My screen lock up a little bit, so I just need to get my PowerPoint pulled back up. But I do want to just thank you for giving us this opportunity to come and address some of the questions that you have. All right, I'm going to share my screen now. Let me know if you're seeing just the PowerPoint presentation.
Perfect.
Okay, wonderful. Well, again, I want to thank you. My name is Andy Lesmeister, and I'm an in-stream flow specialist with the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife. But of course, as you know, Jeanette Becerra, who is our water policy coordinator, and then Adrian Averett, the Water Quality and Quantity Program Manager, are also here to help answer questions. And I'm going to keep this quite brief. I know that you're really interested in getting to the Q&A portion of this, and I want to thank Jake for the presentation, and I think that answered a lot of the questions that you may have had. So we'll just jump right in. If my slide will advance, there we go. So just a brief reminder of why ODFW files for in-stream water rights and a little bit of background to discuss why we've reinstated doing that in the last few years. So it is the mission of the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife to protect and enhance Oregon's fish and wildlife and their habitats for use and enjoyment by present and future generations. And in-stream water rights is just one of the ways that we do that. So Jake went over kind of the history of in-stream water rights pretty nicely, so like I said, I'll keep this brief. But I do want to note the Integrated Water Resources Strategy, which was adopted by the Water Resources Commission, and it states that, you know, in-stream water rights are critical for supporting both healthy ecosystems and healthy economies. And one of the fundamental purposes of the document was to better understand and meet Oregon's water needs, both in and out of stream. And in doing that, there are several objectives and specific actions that are addressed in that document. And ODFW is specifically asked to determine flows to support in-stream needs, and then to establish additional in-stream water rights where needed to protect flows. And so this process of in-stream water rights applications is part of that. And as Jake noted, this is the document that was put together with a tremendous public input and a variety of stakeholder groups. So, of course, in-stream water rights are important for fish and other aquatic species, and we do need to ensure that water is left in stream at portions of the year when, without in-stream water rights, streams may be dry, and in fact are in parts of the state. But there are extended benefits of in-stream water rights that I just want to make sure that we're talking about as well. And those include water quality, cultural values, navigation, climate change resiliency, commercial and recreational fisheries, as well as water and wildlife-based recreation and tourism. And so just a couple of quick slides. This is an ODFW publication that addresses the economic benefits of commercial fisheries. And of course, commercial fisheries are very important for the region there, and those commercial fisheries also depend on healthy streams. I won't read the values to you, but I just wanted to put that up there. And then another report that recently came out, actually I think it was just released within the past couple of weeks, addressing the economic benefits of recreation, both statewide, but also specifically on the South Coast. And I just want to point out that is certainly a major contributor to the economy in that region. And having healthy streams and in-stream water rights helps support that recreational economy, as well as other things like commercial and recreational fisheries. So, like I said, I know you have specific questions. If questions aren't answered here or they come up afterwards, you can always feel free to reach out to me. And so I'll just leave that up for a moment.
Would you like us to do the questions after all four or five of you present? Would that be better?
I think they're done.
They're done.
That was it?
This is all the presenting, I believe.
I thought there was one more coming.
No, I believe that's it.
Director Crockett, do you want to?
Sure. I would point you back to the two-page memo that I put together as far as figuring out what questions that you want to ask. Probably the one question that I'm still perplexed about after listening to the presentation is when I look at the public notification on these streams, there's identification of how much water is requested for in-stream use. Under fish life and fish habitat, the numbers exceed what is identified as the estimated average natural flow in some cases. And I would just like somebody to clarify why the request is larger than the estimated average natural flow in the stream for some months. That seems contrary to the presentation.
Natural average flow. However, under our rules, we have to use habitat-based flows, but we then take those habitat-based flows, which sometimes are greater than the estimated natural average flow, in order to meet those species-specific life stage flow needs. And so when we request flows, we request those flows that are sufficient to meet that need for the beneficial uses that ODFW applies for. Those are based on studies, and then we pass that through a hydrological filter. And so we can request between 30 to 70% of the average natural flow, of the hydrologic record or modeled flows. So that is one of the reasons for those differences. And there is an exception when WRD can grant flows higher than that, but we do make it a point to apply for the flows that are needed for the species in those reaches that we're applying.
Ms. Les?
Commissioners, I'd like to add just a pinch to that, if you don't mind.
Certainly.
So our flows are based on habitat models, and they are for the species that are present within those streams. And keep in mind that the water resources model is water that's there half of the time, and fish need water more than half the time, which is something I'm fond of saying. But you think of these life histories of these species, and some of them are in fresh water up to 7 years, and then they go out to the ocean and they come back. So they need water, you know, available to them year round, and more than half of the time for their survivability. So that's why they're different, I think.
Thank you. Ms. Lesmister, one of your slides there on the extended benefits of the in-stream water rights started off with water quality and then navigation. Could you give us just a little detail on that, what that's referencing, the navigation portion? I think there was five lists there. I don't know if you can go back to that slide, not necessary, but curious on that one.
I think I've stopped sharing my slides, is that right?
Yeah, we stopped.
Okay, I can pull those back up if you like. So that slide, you know, is specific to basically all in-stream water rights. And so certainly in rivers where navigation and commerce
are common, then that having water in streams is beneficial use for that. And also to support, as we said, the commercial and economic fisheries. And so this was just kind of a general listing, not necessarily that full list that I started out with, not necessarily specific to Curry County's economic situation.
Okay. But is it for the fish to navigate, or, you know, when we hear that word down here, it means either in a drift boat or a motorized boat, or, you know, is it accessible by wading across? Can you navigate from one side to the other? Not a big deal.
Yes, you're right. That was referring to transportation and navigation in watercraft.
Okay. Thank you again.
I have some more questions, if I may.
Certainly.
I would add to that, it's important for fish to navigate as well. You know, our flows that we recommend include flows that are maintaining passage throughout the system for fish to go upstream and downstream. So, different concept, but also included.
Pretty close. Thank you.
So, I would like to hear from Water Resources on what their thoughts are in regards to ODFW proposing some in-stream water allocations that are higher than what Water Resources has identified as the estimated natural flow.
Thanks, Becky. I'll take that one. This is Ivan Gall here in Salem again. As Ann and Danette pointed out, ODFW has different rules and frankly different goals in Oregon than the Water Resources Department. You know, traditionally we were set up to be an allocation type agency, and then as time went on, it became more important to understand the value of in-stream flows. So from our perspective, it's perfectly fine that they apply for more water than those median natural flow values that are there. Our rules in place don't allow us to give out any more water than those median natural flows. So our rules effectively cap what we're able to issue through the allocation process for those in-stream water rights. Does that answer the question?
Yes, thank you. I have a couple other questions,
sure,
if it's
certainly.
Okay. Okay, this is in regards to ODFW, I believe. I guess the big question I have is, where is the justification? I know you showed a plan, the 2017 plan, but where's the justification for the proposed limitations that the in-stream rights would impose to further development and economic opportunities in Curry County? I'm asking if ODFW balances their proposal with the impacts that we would see happen in Curry County in regards to potentially thwarting development.
Well, I would start by saying that we certainly understand that those are very real concerns, and we do try to balance that, but we are also operating under our agency's mission and rules, and one of the state's policies to prevent the depletion of native species, and in-stream water rights is a tool that we can use to meet that objective. So, and again, there are many in-stream water right benefits that I think are important for the region as well, that are supported by healthy streams and having water in streams.
Becky, members of the Board of Commissioners there, this is Ivan Gall again with the Water Resources Department. You know, I would add, if we step back a little bit and look at the broader water law context here in Oregon, one of the very foundations of Oregon water law is you put that water to use or you're going to lose it. You know, water rights here in Oregon are subject to forfeiture after 5 consecutive years of non-use. And that was set up so that people who were ready, willing, and able to take the water and put it to use could grab that water and develop these economic benefits to the local communities there. So it's a use it or lose it type of a scenario. our system doesn't view ODFW, their in-stream water right applications, any differently than a new applicant coming in and applying for all of the remaining water on a particular stream in that basin for some new consumptive use that may or may not provide some economic benefit to the county there. We're fairly neutral in that respect, that we're just going to process the in-stream water right as we would process an application for new consumptive uses there. And so, again, I think those kind of help set that broader context of how the legislature back in the 1987 tried to fit in this idea of protection for in-stream water rights into something that was already 80 years old, the water code of a first-in-time, first-in-right priority date system there.
So another question I have is from probably best addressed from ODFW is, do you have any supportive documentation that would show the injury that could happen to fish if you did not do these in-stream water right application?
That's got to be an ODFW.
Yeah, ODFW. Thanks.
Many of the species are listed as sensitive or, you know, under the Endangered Species Act, and so certainly we do have a responsibility to ensure that these management objectives are meeting the needs of those species in this area. And I'll let, I think, Danette or Adrian, would you like to chime in a little bit there?
Yeah, I was, you know, in addition to having many listed species and limiting factors or opting water and habitat within the freshwater system, I would probably defer to the recent multicoastal species plan. And I don't know the details of that plan, and I apologize for that, but we can find some documentation and refer you to that and send that to you after the meeting.
Well, specifically, let's look at one of the basins. Let's look at the Windchuck River, for example. What data is out there that would cause you to believe that without these in-stream water right applications that those fish are going to suffer? They seem to be doing pretty good right now.
I think it would probably be better to address some of these questions to our district biologists. And so certainly, like I said, continue to reach out, and I'm happy to provide more specifics. But these kind of basin-specific questions are not likely. It would be better to address those with our district biologists as well.
Well, I appreciate that. Go ahead.
I was just going to add, I can't speak specifically to the Windchuck, but if we keep in mind that, you know, most of our systems in Oregon have a species that's listed under the Endangered Species Act, and their habitat is already impaired, the target flows that we identify in in-stream water right applications are what we've identified as their minimum need to survive and reproduce and hopefully enhance the population and get them off the Endangered Species Act. So we're looking at, you know, recovering these species and providing the habitat so they can thrive rather than just not cut ahead like a lot of them are doing across the state.
Right, and I appreciate that, but your application is river specific. It's reach and river specific. So it seems like if you're making the application that you need that water, then there should be corresponding information that shows that those fish in those reaches are currently being harmed. And when somebody wants to protest an action that occurs, let's say you're successful and Water Resources approves one of these applications, anybody that wants to protest them has to pay $800 per stream reach and then go into a process of coming up with the scientific information to justify that action may not be the right action to take. And it seems like before you make an application, you should have the scientific justification per stream reach that says this reach will be harmed unless we make this application for more in-stream rights. So I'm asking where that information comes from. It seems like you just did a generic wand across, you know, the areas in Curry County and said, well, these look good. I'm going to take the in-stream rights for the Windchuck and the Chetco and the Rogue, and there we go. We've got all the water.
Sixes?
Yeah, thank you.
I didn't see elk. Is elk? Was Elk River included?
Yes. Yeah, it's all part of the South Coast.
Why now?
Commissioner Pash?
Ms. Crockett just asked the exact question I was going to ask.
I serve on the Association of Oregon County Board of Directors, and I think one or two of you within the last year when we, pre-COVID, the time there, on one or two of the meetings, we had good information, and the recent send out of the 100-year Oregon Water Plan, as you probably recall, that put Oregon rural sections and counties and areas boy back on their heels because of what Director Crockett just communicated there. Not enough scientific justification for really battling the impacts that it would have on rural Oregon, not just ranchers and farmers, but recreationists and all the above. And so I was really happy to hear her bring up the development part of this concern for rural Oregon, the gap that increases between rural and metro, and it's such a deep subject, in no pun intended, but when you look at the housing, the drastic need of housing that we are suffering in, especially this part of Oregon, but a lot of essentially the entire state, to not to be able to develop without water is a tremendous challenge that again has a lot of people recoiling a little bit and deeply concerned. So I didn't mean to make that a comment form instead of a question, but I'm sure you're getting this from areas outside of the three larger metropolitan counties. Does anybody want to take that on? Just comment. Thank you.
And again, this is Ivan Gall with the Water Resources Department. Go ahead. I was just going to say that, for clarification, the filings from ODFW for these in-stream water rights, these are not going to add more water into the streams and rivers. The attempt is basically to protect some or all of the remaining water in these various stream reaches where the applications were filed. And I've had the luxury of working all across Oregon for over 20 years in the water business here. And almost without fail, every stream in Oregon is deficient in water during the summer months, if not other months of the year. My agency has done an outstanding job in the first 100 years of our business of doing fully allocating or over allocating these surface water bodies to the out of stream consumptive users. So ODFW is doing what they can under their mission, under their goals for their agency, to protect remaining flows in those streams for fish. DEQ does it for water quality considerations. And Oregon Parks and Rec would do it for recreational activities there. So I certainly understand the concerns of the commissioner, but again, there isn't going to be any kind of an add back to surface water flows from the filings of these applications. At some point, Becky, when it's appropriate, I've got some information from your memo. You talk about well locations within a half a mile. I'd like to comment on that as well.
That would be very good. That was kind of the way I was headed. Next question. So, Director Crockett?
Actually, I really appreciate that you brought it up, because that's directly from Marianne Cooper, from the attorney from the Oregon Farm Bureau. Her experience is working with other basins where in-stream rights have been claimed by ODFW, and in fact, it caused people not to be able to get water within a half a mile of a stream. So that's a real example in the state of Oregon. So I would like your opinion on what that's all about.
Yeah, I'd be glad to comment on that. So keep in mind, here in Oregon, there's two types of groundwater uses. The first one is going to be exempt groundwater uses, which are traditionally the wells that are drilled for residential homes, small businesses, stock water wells, small commercial operations. And Oregon water law has a number of exempt groundwater uses where you're able to drill a well and you don't need to file for a water right to use those exempt amounts of groundwater use. So the in-stream water right applications, certificates once issued, will have zero impact on those exempt uses. And frankly, for Curry County and most of the South Coast, there's very little groundwater development going on because, unfortunately, there's very little groundwater to develop. With rare exceptions where we've got pretty coarse sands and gravels and decent aquifer thicknesses, most landowners are happy to get those exempt amounts of groundwater where it's available from a drilled well there. So again, exempt uses, which are going to provide water for homes, small businesses, small commercial operations, stock water, these in-stream water rights don't have any impact on that at all. In the event that someone was lucky enough to drill a good producing well and they wanted to get an irrigation right from that well or a large commercial right or industrial right, they would have to file an application for a new groundwater permit. And that application, as these in-stream water right applications, goes through a number of different review processes here at our agency. One of those review processes is to determine the amount of hydraulic connection and impact from the proposed groundwater use on nearby surface water bodies like streams and rivers. And because of today's water availability and what we call our Division 9 rules that kind of outline how we do that review between surface water and groundwater, any wells that are hydraulically connected to surface water and within a mile of surface water get evaluated for kind of the degree of hydraulic connection and the degree of impact. And I don't want to go into the details, but the half mile isn't really a thing, if you will. Division 9 talks about there's a quarter mile limitation and then a mile limitation on that. So, but the in-stream water right applications aren't going to have a significant impact on them. There is part of the review process where the amount that someone applies for on a new groundwater permit gets compared to a number of different flow values. And one of those flow values is any in-stream water rights in that particular reach. And so that's where a new in-stream water right could have a potential impact on groundwater availability for someone who is seeking a new groundwater right. But there's any number of different combinations that we could talk about there, so I won't go into them.
In Curry County, we have a lot of people that talk about their well as a cistern, and we assume that that is really taking surface water, you know, from what would otherwise be an in-stream right. So that's why we're concerned. I mean, these cistern wells are located close to a stream. So if there's no water availability, then these cisterns that people are developing seem to be a problem.
Yes, if the water master makes the determination that a landowner's source of water is surface water, so it could be a cistern that has surface water flowing into it, or it might be surface water that's piped into it from a stream. Oftentimes springs and seeps are developed on the South Coast. Again, because the groundwater resource is so sparse over there, a lot of folks have tried to drill wells and can't find much well yield or don't have the money to drill wells. they develop these wet spots in the ground. And if those are determined to be tributary to surface water, those would require a surface water right in order to be a legitimate authorized use of that domestic water there.
So if all of the water is allocated to ODFW for the in-stream rights and somebody comes along and they have a cistern or they want to develop a cistern, essentially that would be junior to the in-stream right. And if the in-stream rights are all taken, can Water Resources even issue a right for that cistern?
That's a good question. So generally, if there's no water available for new consumptive uses, the department is not able to issue new water rights in most situations. There have been instances where landowners have been able to make the case that there are no other alternatives for water. Trucking water is not a viable source. Drilled wells are not a viable source. Hooking up to neighbors' wells isn't an option. And in limited circumstances like that, I believe the department has issued what we call human consumption rights for residents like that. If that's a concern for Curry County, and I think it is, and I think it's a legitimate concern, those are the type of comments I think that would be helpful to the Water Resources Department to get submitted in response to these in-stream water rights. And I don't know that you necessarily need to send in the same comment for each of the filed in-stream water rights. It would probably be sufficient to send in one letter from Curry County that outlines the various concerns and maybe references on the most recent number of filings there in Curry County.
Very helpful.
And I would also...
Please go ahead, Ms. Lechtmeister.
Thanks. I just wanted to address one thing that seems to be coming up here, and that's that the amount of appropriation for out-of-stream uses is not a factor in determining our in-stream water rights because they're based on natural stream flow. So one thing that I did want to point out here is that in Curry County right now, for the four where the initial reviews have been completed, so for those four during the months where ODFW is applying for an in-stream water right, there is only one of those streams right now where water is actually available for out-of-stream requests during any of the months that ODFW applied for. So three of those rivers that already there's not a water available according to the WARS, WRD's WARS database. And so we do, even though those in-stream water rights may not really translate into water, more water being on the stream presently, those are goals and they help agencies and other partners in stream restoration efforts.
Thank you.
There's another issue that I'd like to address, if this would be an appropriate time to do it, but regarding the migration of channels due to high flow events. There was concern that PODs could be affected by the in-stream water rights due to, a large water event pushing a channel. There is a statute 545.10 that addresses it's loosely called chasing water by the water masters, but it basically allows for you to move your pump to encounter water should there be such an event, as long as you're not leapfrogging other points of diversion. So I just wanted to put that one out there as well.
Okay. Certainly. Okay, just a little bit of a clarification on the rogue system. You said those weren't out for public comment yet. Is that true? Did I understand that correct?
The audio was a little rough there, but I think you're asking about them being available for public comment. There are 100 that went out for public comment on the 19th, and the other ones are still in that initial review phase where they're creating the model so that they can see what estimated natural stream flows are there. That answers your question.
Yeah, I think it does. Yeah, I don't have any more questions.
Mr. Johnson, anyone could answer this, but just give us a sequence, if you could. You know, Oregon Water Resources down to water rights. Where does the watershed councils fit in? Does it? What's the national effect on, you know, the state of Oregon and the connections there? You know, just like we have the U.S. Fish and Game connected with, in some ways, the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife. Where does it start and generally those different departments blend in? Okay, so Oregon Water Resources, give me the structure there, that the chart below you.
Sure. So Commissioner, you mentioned watershed councils. So watershed councils are generally localized nonprofit groups that will reach out to different state and federal entities to solicit grant funding for, say, a riparian habitat project or maybe some efficiencies on some irrigation equipment. You know, that's generally how the watershed councils will operate. There are also soil and water conservation districts that get their funding. I believe they're like sub-housed under USDA, gets them money as well, that will also do irrigation efficiency projects. The Oregon Water Resources Department is one of a little over 50 state agencies. And we have our water masters, which loosely get referred to as county water masters, as many of their districts align with county geography. But we are a state agency funded by general fund dollars primarily, and that's about where we sit. ODF&W being a sister agency, also funded through the state. So we will work cooperatively with watershed councils. Sometimes we'll offer support for one of their grant projects, that kind of thing. And I believe ODF&W gets involved as well when there's efficiencies or fish streams or fish bypasses as part of maybe a dam renovation. I'm happy to let anybody else jump in, though, if that didn't answer your question or if you'd like some more clarity.
No, it's very helpful. You said 50 departments, so under Oregon Water Resources Department.
No, under the state of Oregon.
Gotcha, okay.
Yeah, state agencies. There's a little over 50.
I couldn't even name a couple, so I didn't think that was right. I appreciate that, though, very much. Anybody else want to weigh in on that?
Well, I was going to just go up above our agency to the federal government. You know, there's quite a bit of federal case law out there where the state is actually responsible across the country for management of water. So federal agencies typically have to defer to state water law for management purposes. Here in Oregon, we have large projects built and operated by the Bureau of Reclamation and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Corps of Engineers typically has built dams, good examples of Willamette system for flood control purposes. Bureau of Reclamation has typically built water storage facilities for irrigation purposes, and there's some crossover in some areas as in here in the Willamette as an example. But ultimately, the day-to-day water allocation and water management falls on our agency, the Water Resources Department here in Oregon, and that holds true for most of the rest of the country.
Very good.
I just want to thank all you guys on the screen. This is a difficult place to have the conversation like this because it's a hard issue to discuss, but I think you guys did an excellent job. Wouldn't you agree? They answered our questions, and I really appreciate it. Thank you.
The old-timers used to say many thanks, and to have five of you join in with us, very helpful, very informative, and come down here and visit sometime if you haven't been lately. Beautiful area. Thank you again.
You bet. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
Excellent job.
Take care.
Bye now.
Bye.
I'll kill the meeting.
So How about if we take 5 minutes before we go to our next workshop? Did you want to conclude with anything? I might even have a couple questions for you if it's okay.
Yeah.
More discussion is in order.
I think that the board should consider writing a letter.
Just hold that mic up.
Yeah, Mr. Gall recommended identifying and outlining the Curry County concerns, maybe even somewhat specifically. Is that where you're going?
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't know how you guys feel about this issue, but it will impact people that, you know, want to drill wells that are close to a stream. It will impact them. It will impact the farmers that are looking to, you know, expand their water rights or move their existing points of diversion. That's what he was talking about at the end. Pardon me?
Cranberry growers.
Definitely the cranberry growers. And I don't know where the city of Brookings is in regards to any potential increase in the water allocation on the Chetco. I know they've looked at more storage options, but I haven't had a chance to talk to them about what's going on right here. And this is one of those issues that it's so difficult to grasp what is going to happen as a result. And yet, it's so easy for these agencies, quite frankly, to just come in and they feel they have the right and the need to protect something that may not need extra protection. And the result is that there is a real impact. There is a real economic impact to people.
Makes me nervous.
It makes me nervous. And to protest.
Why now?
And the
if you
action,
read the 100-year water plan, you'll really be nervous.
Yeah, well, it is concerning because it literally will cut people off in the future, and there's no question. So, yeah, I would suggest a letter from the Board of Commissioners in response to what's being proposed is probably a good idea.
Can you go ahead?
I just, one of the things that bothered me is they wouldn't really define the difference between a spring and surface water runoff.
They're the same thing. They're surface water. That's why anybody near a stream that is trying to tap into that stream as a water source, and that happens a lot in Curry County. And what was identified here is that we really don't have groundwater. We have surface water. And surface water is what they're talking about, allocating all of the rest of it to fish. And, you know, we all support fish. There's no question about that. But, you know, do you want to support people also?
Problem is the requirements down here in rural Oregon aren't the same as the people that are going to vote on this in big cities.
Yeah,
that's correct.
They don't know what we need down here.
Yeah.
Commissioner Herzog?
I was just going to add, you know, I would rather ODF&W concentrate on getting the fish hatchery below the Lost River, or, you know, Lost Creek Dam,
mm-hmm.
You know, that fish hatchery operating, instead of worrying about the Windchuck, the Chetco, Sixes River, Elk River. The Rogue River needs help. Elk River's got a fish hatchery, but I don't like it when they start coming in and saying, and I just wonder why now? Why now do they want rights to our streams?
Yeah.
I mean, they have rights. I mean, I've grown up here, and I've helped ODF&W go gather salmon and trout even in the and cutthroat and done all that where you go put a net out and they've always had seemed like rights to do that but this has taken control where I don't want them to.
And in compounding is the climate change issue, whether you agree or not. I mean, that is getting a lot of political momentum throughout the state, throughout the country. And as Mr. Pasha said, that's where the metropolitan people come in, and they're really not aware. It's not that they're just indifferent, but they're not aware of what we are dealing with in the rural areas. And I'm so glad you brought up development, and I don't know, you know, not very many irresponsible developers out there, but water is so key, and management of it is something that we can contribute to. I'm wondering, you had one of your recommended discussion items here, five, and I don't think they answered this, but maybe you want to respond. Understand justification for proposed limitations that ISWRs would impose to further development and economic opportunities in Curry County. I mean, we're repeating that question, but it needs to be repeated, I think.
Yeah, and I think they touched on it, but the reality is it gets back to, do we have groundwater availability or do we have surface water that people are really tapping into when they ask for a water right to develop their property? It's surface water that people are taking. It's very rare that it's groundwater that they're asking to get a water right for. So
that's easier for them to control the surface water is.
Well, the surface water is what we're talking about as far as, ODFW is going to take it.
So could you, I hate to ask, but could one of you or one of your staff give us a draft on that?
Absolutely.
Would you love to, yes.
And
identifying, the diversity that we have in Curry County when it comes to agriculture and the different population sections and, the cities and outlying areas, all the above. You might try, I'd recommend considering recapturing that a little bit with, that diversity, and yet a common denominator there, and that's everybody needs water. And
the other thing I would mention is this is not happening just in Curry County. Their proposal is for Coos County and Douglas County as well, so it probably behooves the commissioners to coordinate with those counties as well. I understand that they're not real happy about this either.
Well, you've done a terrific job here, and you're right, they're not, they're as Commissioner Herzog said, we're all pretty nervous, and we're going to have pushback, and we're going to have to go beyond just working with the governor and the legislature. Definitely. Thank you again. So we'll close this workshop, take a 5 to 10 minute break, be back here before 3:15. Oh, are we going to run out of time for the next workshop? Let's see. We got
3:30. 4 o'clock.
What's that? We have a 3:30, right?
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock.
Okay, not, okay.
3:30 we already did.
That's right, thank you. So let's be back here at...
How long do you need, Summer?
So it's 20 minutes on the...
I think that'll be fine. Let's get everybody back here at 3:15. Thank you.
Something about having land and sea. Never having to choose between digging in or looking out. Here, you can go where the spirit or the wind moves you. To the tops of the trees, along secluded beaches, or into more wild and scenic rivers than anywhere else in the western United States. We're the closest place to the sunset while still keeping your feet dry, and a destination where anyone can begin. We share more than we keep, so you can see more than you imagined. This is a place you have to touch, hold, and feel to believe. The entire shoreline of the West Coast's best coast is open to you. And playgrounds made of forests are waiting for you. Escape to Curry County and don't leave anything out.
If yours is the next big idea, and you need the right place to fine-tune it, build it, launch it, if you're only your best when you can play more than you work, if inspiration comes from the outside, you belong in Curry County. The westernmost point of the land you love, and the edge between familiar and uncharted. Break the pattern. Be where the airports are as close as the beaches, and industry and recreation never cease to amaze. Dock, dive, and dine in a single day, and never lose your connection. This is the threshold of the West. Live where you can do you and do it well at the farthest point from ordinary. Curry County, living on the edge.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Wildfire, as everyone knows, has emerged as one of the big major issues affecting Oregon and, for that matter, all western states. A real actionable response that's including how do we fight fire, actively managing our forests so that we don't have the fuels out there, and how are we going to protect communities from smoke exposures. The council is really set up to have a comprehensive strategy that's based on action and based on protecting our communities.
The primary focus we as a board have come through with is that in researching the policies for fire management, yes, prescribed fire has its place on the landscape, but not during fire season. We, as a county, passed a proclamation that says once the state fire marshal declares fire season, it'll be nothing but full suppression. And recently took a resolution to the National Association of Counties, essentially says that they support coordination between agencies and local governments for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens regarding fire, prescribed fire, fire season, anything that affects our citizens.
This is Lily Morgan from Josephine County, and we are at the Rogue Leadership Forum today looking at the best possible partnerships that we can come up with to fight the fire issues and the smoke issues that we're facing in Southwest Oregon. So looking forward to coming up with solutions and the partnerships to get the job done so we don't face what we have the last few years with catastrophic fires and smoke that invades our communities for months to come. So this is a good opportunity, and we hope to be successful in the outcome.
Seeing so many people come together has really been exciting for me, because there's a lot of expertise, there's a lot of resources, and as we attempt to do a shared stewardship approach to keeping people safe, it's really important that we get together. So my name is Merv George Jr., and I'm the forest supervisor for the Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest. One of the first things is making sure to get fires out if they're threatening life and property. The second thing that I'm going to focus in on is when it's safe to do so, to put some fire on the landscape when it's cooler and not during fire season, to reduce these same fuels that are giving us so much fits during the fire season.
Bob Horton, I'm the fire chief of Jackson County Fire District 3 in Southern Oregon.
315, welcome back.
Thank you, Commissioner. Second part of our Curry County Commissioner workshop projects, unpacking the need for grant writing. Summer Madison, Economic Development Coordinator.
Good afternoon.
Good, welcome.
Thanks. This is not a presentation, just a conversation. So, you know, we talk a lot about the need for a grant writer, and we have some pretty big projects that we don't get funded because we don't have that resource. And I've got to say, our department heads do a really great job in maintaining the grants they're able to make time for. But if you review the strategic plan for the county, and you look at that with the vision of a grant writer, do you have a copy of that?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
I will get a copy.
Between the vision, mission, and values, and then the strategic goals, Fiscal responsibility really highlights the need for a grant writer, and we actually call that out specifically in the strategic plan. So I think it's important that we revisit that strategic plan on a regular basis. It's a 5-year plan. We need to kind of chart where we are and how much further we need to go to get to where we said we would be. That's part of the transparency in that plan. So we, with the help of the finance department, we dissected the grants that we have on file probably for the past 10, 12 years. And they broke down to these simple categories. And when you take a look at those, really the emphasis is on public safety, social services, and community development.
Say those again, please. Do you mind?
Public safety, social services, community development.
Thank you.
And so when I say social services, that's not what your initial inclination to think is as far as state services go, but that's, in all honesty, most of the services that we provide. Okay, and I'm sure there's a ton of little niches that are left out of here, but this is the overall. So I'm gonna actually minimize this, and because what I'm gonna do is show you what this is. I made you all copies, but I wanted a PowerPoint for the record and for Mr. Barnes. So I came up with a list of questions last week. I want to know what other counties are doing. I think part of the blessing in living in a rural area is that we have many other like counties. And so what are they doing? You know, what are they not doing? What's working? What's not? Saves us a lot of time and money. So we put some questions out there. Sent them to Commissioner Boyce, and he got a hold of 17 counties in the state, which is about half of our counties, and propose some questions. Do you have a grant writer or a grant program manager? Are they on staff or are they contracted? How is it budgeted? TLT, general fund, administrative fees? Overall, have you found it to be a financial gain or loss? Is it department specific or general county service? And do you utilize a software platform for grant management? So we got two full pages of answers from a few counties. And
I got two more this morning, by the way.
Yeah, they continue to come in. I'm grateful for that.
Yeah.
What we did tell our partner counties was, whatever's disseminated here and we pulled together, we'll turn right back around and we're going to share that with you, because as you read through the details, you'll see so many of them are in the same boat as us. So maybe we're taking the lead in the conversation, and maybe that gives us the opportunity to collaborate on a grander scale. So all of the details are here with our answers, and some of them didn't give specific answers, but did make statements. So you'll find that those are detailed out here in the back. Miranda was kind enough to do us a little pie chart, because sometimes we like the visuals. And so you'll see on the front, all that data is broken down, and that input's broken down. Are they exploring getting a grant writer? Are they a full-time staff grant writer? Do they contract? Kind of helps us check the pulse on, you know, what everybody else is doing. And some of the feedback they give on some of the questions is really great. So I'd certainly encourage you to read those, and our department heads. Okay, so I'm just going to go back, because that's all this is just the data on the paper.
Can you scroll down just a little bit, see on the contracted one there? It looks like it's about, not 20%, but 15 maybe? 12, excuse me, okay. Good.
Yeah, so when you see like grant writer is a combined role, it's not that person's only job. Or maybe they're a department head, and so they do grant writing in addition to their regular duties. And sometimes they're shared. So it's just very interesting what's working for everybody and what's not, and it will be nice to look and say, hey, that might work for us. So I'm going to go ahead and minimize this. And we're going to go to another file I thought I had on here.
While you're looking there, I didn't contact the AOC District 4 counties. I will at some point, but I'd also add your comment, you know, kind of your long-term vision to let them know our findings. There's at least 10 counties out there that are very interested in that, and you know, a good way to proceed.
Okay, so coming back to this document, what I did after I itemized or categorized the grants that we typically see being applied for, I went into the contracting, outsourcing, and staffing of grants. So based on the feedback from our counties, I'm looking at how that might apply to us with those different positions. So what I detailed here is just a grant writer, and kind of gave a brief explanation of what that looks like. And that's not hard and steadfast. Of course, that can be combined from anything, but just an idea. So I research, draft, and submit proposals that help organizations or individuals receive grant funding to be eligible for funding. An organization or individual must have an objective that aligns with the grant's specifications. As of January 2021, the average hourly pay for a grant writer in the United States is $24.45 an hour. ZipRecruiter is seeing hourly wages as high as $100 and as low as $20 an hour. The majority of grant writer wages currently range between $19.47 and $28.61 across the United States. So I didn't run hard numbers on what that would look like as a county employee. But you can envision that, you know, that might be, you know, on the low range of an employee, but that certainly wouldn't be the total cost. We definitely look at maybe doubling that if somebody was an employee here at the county. And then contingency fees or percentage fees are commission-based payments issued to professionals only if there is a favorable result from their work. In the case of grant writing, it means that a grant writer is paid based on a percentage of the grant awarded. The average grant writer salary, cost, benefits included, is $48,863. So I find that interesting because that's based on, you know, output and production. They really have to work to get paid for that, and so it's just not a kind of a hobby project. You know, they want to make some money from that. So
$48,000 a year is $49,000 is. That is per year, correct?
Yeah.
Sure.
For grant writer.
Benefits included.
That does not include the benefits.
Okay, it says benefits included there.
Does it?
Yes, it does.
Oh, my apologies.
That's
that,
okay.
That is, the other one is not.
Okay.
This one up top. Okay.
So the $49,000 does not include benefits. Misprint. No worries.
No, that's not a misprint. I copied okay. that from the
All
state.
Right. That gives a good perspective, though. Very helpful.
Yeah, I thought so. So then this is the grant program manager and director perspective. So they're also known as award managers or budgets and grants managers. Grants managers are tasked with planning and implementing grant programs, preparing budgets, research funding opportunities, supervising grant staff, monitoring expenditures, identifying support agencies, tracking results, and analyzing financial data. The average salary for the role of a grants program manager in the United States is $62,400. So kind of looking at some of the tasks in those job descriptions, in my opinion, I feel like there's a few from both that the county could potentially benefit from. It's not just a one or the other. So I find that interesting. Okay, so here's another option that I wanted to bring to the table. County supported grant writing. So as of now, our department heads or our departments are independently responsible for writing their grants. And that goes okay until they find out about a grant and they have 2 days to write it, and they're a department of two. And so more often than not, either they'll breeze through it and they won't get the funding, or they just won't apply. So one of the key things I thought was really helpful with grant program manager is that they maintain a schedule and a calendar. So you know the grants that come up quarterly, annually, biannually, one-time grants, what departments might be most eligible, which is helpful because maybe a grant program manager would also help us bounce those opportunities off other jurisdictions or nonprofits so that we are complementing one another's work and not competing. So, look this up. SWAC offers a total of 4 grant writing courses. I wanted to provide this one because this may be an option that you find interest in. Basically, it's a 6-week program. There's 3 courses here. Each one is 6 weeks. Each one is $100. And each one kind of steps you up into the level of grant writing. And for a total investment of $10,000, $500 per department, 20 departments, $10,000, we may want to look at a professional development program like this and then develop a part-time position or something like that, either hired as staff or contracted out based on what we provide for county staff. In my opinion, your department heads know more about the needs of their community and their staff and their equipment than, you know, a grant writer will. So there's got to be some kind of mirror and partnership there where we could really make something work. Anyway, so this course is the 6-week course. It's the basics, the A to Z's. You know, I know nothing. Here's where I'm going to learn what the heck grant writing's really about. And then this one's advanced grant proposal writing. So this kind of gets a little deeper into the nitty-gritty and the body of grants and what really is going to help you complete it efficiently. The third one is just like the powerhouse of you're here. Now, this is how you can do it better than anybody else kind of a thing and really find success and see those success rates go up. In some of the job descriptions that I was researching and positions in Oregon, they're seeing anywhere from a 73 to a 96% success rate for the top 100 grant writers in Oregon. 73 to 96. So
say that one more time, please.
73 to 96% success rate for the top 100 grant writers in Oregon.
Okay.
So I found that interesting. So then I started looking at their qualifications. And a lot of it mirrors with what's in our strategic plan and some of the grants that we're already looking to fulfill. So if we can look at those strengths that we currently have at the county and the weaknesses and the gaps that we need to fill and kind of start modeling a plan, I think that you might be able to consider what kind of grant position you want to fill. And maybe the larger overarching contracts for grants are something that we contract out. I just wanted to bring the discussion because I know it's been brought up many times, and I don't want you to be in a position where it's a yes or a no, but it's a how are we going to make this work, because it is in our strategic plan. So we owe it to the plan and the citizens to really talk about it.
You know, it's been a little bit of a source of frustration because we've missed some key funds available that we could have qualified for, and you know, I believe I hear you saying we could. It's only a 24-hour course over a 6-week period.
Mm-hmm.
That's like one day a week, 4 hours a day, something like that. But it doesn't give the total cost.
It's $100 per course, per 6-week course. I did
Wow.
put it in here, I think. Yeah, here we go. So 20 departments at $500, and really it's $300, but what I did factor in is a $33 an hour offset if somebody was not willing to do that on their personal time. So there's some leverage in there. But think about that. A $10 investment, $10,000 investment to have 20 employees in this county prepared and ready to write grants. Not saying they have the time to, but it sure would take a lot less time if they had the skills and they were equipped to do it efficiently. Also, the cost of a grant writer compared to the $10,000, that's a drop in the bucket. Literally in 6 months, we have some very qualified people on staff. And maybe from there, you figure out what kind of grant writer you want.
Would there be, what would be the just off the top of your head, the incentive for employees to get that training and then follow through?
The incentive, well?
I mean, we have people who want to produce for their department, certainly.
Mm-hmm.
And you wisely mentioned time, you know, time allowed, and how that could all fit in. But that's very interesting there.
So could you repeat that question, Commissioner?
Just an incentive to want to take that course, because that's no small commitment, even if just a 24-hour.
You're absolutely right. That's a great thought. I've got to tell you that the more that we invest in the professional development of our employees, the more loyal and long-term they will be. And this is a great example of having faith in the staff that you've hired and believing in them. And let's just think about it. Maybe they take this course and we invest $300, $400, $500 into them, and they decide, you know, I'm really going to go work for this nonprofit. Chances are pretty good that nonprofit's still going to be in the county. Is still going to benefit us in one way or another.
Well said. Well said. Do we take public comment at a workshop?
Yeah. You have it on the agenda.
Is it?
Yes.
Yep.
Very good. Mr. Barnes.
Just on this one specific point, there's a screen up here before you talk about incentive. You give your employees 2%. Of any grants they get it, they take in. You know, 3%, 5%, up to X number of dollars, that's an incentive. You know, if you go out and you apply for a $100,000 grant, you're gonna get $2,000 if you get this grant, that's an incentive. You know, I mean, I don't know that we have, you know, that we have to give it out to, I've listened to this and I understand. Brad, do you know how many grants we have and what departments? That's the first issue that you really need to look at, is how many grants the county has and which departments have which grants for which amount of money, what the compliance rate is on those grants. Before you start hiring more people or writing more grants, we really need to understand everything. And that's a job of, like Summer said, a grant manager or a program manager. You need somebody, whether it would be a director of something, or somebody needs to be in charge of all these different grants that all the different county departments get, because you're on the hook for them if they go bad. Mm-hmm. So it's really something that you should consider. But then, like I said, it's an incentive. You know, if you give people 2% of the grants that they get, that's a big incentive to get employees out there, because they don't get bonuses working for the county otherwise. Thank you.
Yeah, 2018, that was a big issue with Commissioner Huxley, and then why we almost lost the $1.6 million Head Start program at Brookings, because we were not managing that well. So in fairness to him, that was definitely an issue. As far as incentive goes, if you pay for the training and give them the encouragement, you know, people do generally respond very well to training and appreciative of that. And they want to be productive, so that's a very good point. As far as the percentage goes, I wouldn't argue with that, you know, at least initially. If it helps their department and helps the county in general, I think most people would take the lead in that. Commissioner Pash?
I also think if we get three or four people to train and for writing grants, you know, initially to get started, they all work together to get go after a specific grant, and they help each other along in the process. That's how you learn to produce. So it'd be kind of fun. Mm-hmm. I'd actually probably want to get involved in doing that, and I'd pay for my own part of it if we got other people to do it with me. I'd do that.
24 hours. Excuse me, Commissioner.
Okay. I was just wondering, Summer, could we poll the departments to say, you know, what are your thoughts on, would you be interested in taking a class for 24 hours? It'd be actually 24 times 3. You know,
I think engaging your department heads in that conversation speaks volumes.
Yeah, so, I mean, if the board agrees, poll them and a little survey or something, or what do you think? And
yes, sir.
I think the first thing to do, though, would be, as Mr. Barnes said, you know, find out what departments draw and grant, you know, fill out for grants, what grants we have out there, where we file for those grants on an annual basis, on a biannual basis, and go to those department heads first. And that's where you can, I think, draw from initially. Identifying the grants that we need is the first step.
So the treasurer, historically, or just recently, has been tracking and monitoring, and that's kind of, it's kind of bounced from person to person. In 2014, there really wasn't that person, and that was actually one of the first tasks that I had when I started with the county, was figure out what grants we have. And boy howdy, that was a quick way to figure out what we're really doing, you know, is what we were getting funding for. And then the finance director took that over. I think county council at some point's taken that over. I think director of operations tried to, and now it's back at treasurer. So it's difficult too, because there's not a real, you know, a dark line that says this is a grant, but there are some that are renewable without deliverables, you know, one and done. There are contracts for open-ended funding. So probably identifying those different categories of funding that we receive would be helpful too, but I gotta tell you, we already receive so much in grants, and it's incredible to me that every department, there was only 21 departments noted on our internal phone list, and the only department that I didn't specify as eligible for this was the surveyor, because we contract that out.
So I have two primary questions so far. Existing grant management, that's what we have in inventory right now, then pulling the departments. What else do you want to add to that? What's the key departments that we would want to focus on to start with if we went this direction?
Well, maybe you could ask the departments too, you know, especially those folks that have been here a while, and so they have a real good history of what's worked and not, you know, maybe going through those positions or even those material and highlighting, yeah, we would like this kind of support. We're not so efficient here, but we're okay here. And maybe kind of pulling that information in to help you form, you know, more of an idea of what you're looking for.
So we could have some fun with this and catch up.
I think so.
Which we've been wanting to do for a long time.
I know I have staff that would be very excited. She really wants to take on grants and just doesn't have the experience, but really just has a passion for wanting to be successful and say, look what I brought in, I did my job, and it was more than I expected, so.
It is really cool.
It really is, it's rewarding.
I think it would be quite contagious.
Yeah. Yes.
All right.
Commissioners?
I'm good.
You good?
Director Rickert?
Sounds great.
We've got Clerk Cohen in the audience. Anything?
Nope.
Thank you for being here. Director Madison, or Coordinator Madison, what else?
I just thank you for your time, and, you know, really, I'm not looking for any decisions. I just wanted to open the conversation and see where we could take it, and I appreciate you taking into consideration the staff that this affects, both in time and staff support, so I'm sure they'll be anxious to respond.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
We'll get you those other two counties or three counties that have contributed some insight, and let me know what else we can do in that area, and then maybe get a little bit of a plan how we can come back to the board in a couple weeks or something, perhaps.
Yeah, definitely taking into consideration, too, if you do look at training some staff. The cool thing about the SWAT courses is they start once a month. So you don't have to wait 6 months. They've got another one. Doug Bunn is such a mastermind when it comes to scheduling and making those resources available for folks like us that work full-time and more. So if you weren't able to start in a month or two, you know, there's another one the month after.
Okay. Reliable rotation on that, once
yeah.
every month.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. Wow.
Thank you
Thank
for
you.
Your time.
Thank you. We've got 20 minutes. Everybody meet back here at 4 o'clock.
Okay.
Is that okay? This workshop is closed.
Something about having land and sea. Never having to choose between digging in or looking out. Here, you can go where the spirit or the wind moves you. To the tops of the trees, along secluded beaches, or into more wild and scenic rivers than anywhere else in the western United States. We're the closest place to the sunset while still keeping your feet dry, and a destination where anyone can begin. We share more than we keep, so you can see more than you imagined. This is a place you have to touch, hold, and feel to believe. The entire shoreline of the West Coast's best coast is open to you. And playgrounds made of forests are waiting for you. Escape to Curry County and don't leave anything out.
If yours is the next big idea, and you need the right place to fine-tune it, build it, launch it. If you're only your best when you can play more than you work. If inspiration comes from the outside, you belong in Curry County. The westernmost point of the land you love, and the edge between familiar and uncharted. Break the pattern. Be where the airports are as close as the beaches, and industry and recreation never cease to amaze. Dock, dive, and dine in a single day, and never lose your connection. This is the threshold of the West. Live where you can do you, and do it well, at the farthest point from ordinary. Curry County, living on the edge.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Wildfire, as everyone knows, has emerged as one of the big major issues affecting Oregon, and for that matter, all western states. A real actionable response that's including how do we fight fire, actively managing our forests so that we don't have the fuels out there, and how are we going to protect communities from smoke exposures. The council is really set up to have a comprehensive strategy that's based on action and based on protecting our communities.
The primary focus we as a board have come through with is that in researching the policies for fire management, yes, prescribed fire has its place on the landscape, but not during fire season. We, as a county, passed a proclamation that says once the state fire marshal declares fire season, it'll be nothing but full suppression. And recently took a resolution to the National Association of Counties, essentially says that they support coordination between agencies and local governments for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens regarding fire, prescribed fire, fire season, anything that affects our citizens. This is Lily Morgan from Josephine County, and we are at the Rogue Leadership Forum today, looking at the best possible partnerships that we can come up with to fight the fire issues and the smoke issues that we're facing in Southwest Oregon. So looking forward to coming up with solutions and the partnerships to get the job done so we don't face what we have the last few years with catastrophic fires and smoke that invades our communities for months to come. So this is a good opportunity and we hope to be successful in the outcome.
Seeing so many people come together has really been exciting for me because there's a lot of expertise, there's a lot of resources, and as we attempt to do a shared stewardship approach to keeping people safe, it's really important that we get together. So my name is Merv George Jr. and I'm the forest supervisor for the Rogue River Siskiyou National Forest. One of the first things is making sure to get fires out if they're threatening life and property. The second thing that I'm going to focus in on is when it's safe to do so, to put some fire on the landscape when it's cooler and not during fire season, to reduce these same fuels that are giving us so much fits during the fire season.
Bob Horton, I'm the fire chief of Jackson County Fire District 3 in Southern Oregon. The challenges that are facing us in terms of the mega fires and the wildfires that we've been experiencing out in this valley, particularly in the last couple of years, but across the state and across the region, incredibly concerning to us in the fire community, those in our communities in general, our constituents and our patrons are extremely concerned as they ought to be. And really the takeaway from the work that's being done now is this is an extraordinary collaboration of dozens on dozens of interested stakeholder groups who are coming together with a common purpose. It's really an inspiring showing of humanity to not only be able to provide for a greater quality of life for our people, but to be strong stewards of our land so that our future for us and generations to come is incredibly bright.
Very pressing issue. It's bearing down on us. Fire season is approaching, and I am really interested in preventing my home and other homes in my community from being impacted by wildfire, specifically from being burnt down. That's my main reason for being involved.
Quite a collaboration of folks. We're here looking for practical solutions to help us unravel some of the issues surrounding wildfires today here in the state of Oregon. And my focus really is on planning for large wildfire events in advance of their occurrence. That way, when they do occur, we can respond more appropriately to those situations.
Well, I just think it's grand of all of the people all over the state have come together today to be concerned about water. It just warms my heart because I know that they really will leave here today feeling more impressed about the water because I have told them that we're all born in water. We cannot live without it. It's our job to take care of it, stop the garbage in the rivers and streams and oceans because there's life in that water and it's our job to keep it clean for them. But we cannot live on this planet without the animal kingdom. I was in Ohio at the Ohio River when Dr. Emoto, the Japanese scientist who had proven water could hear, he and I stood on the riverbank and blessed the Ohio River that they had us come to do. And I prayed that God has still kept the river good for them over there. We were taught when we were little that prayer works. You too remember your prayers because they work. It has nothing to do with religion or church.
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on.
if you're concerned about crime. Get a regular flu shot. Drive to work. Take public transportation. Or experience a natural disaster in your community. Chances are you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation's capital is considered a county. These county governments ensure that the food you eat in restaurants is safe. They care for the mentally ill, run court systems, build local economies, and operate 911 emergency systems. They manage parks and recreation facilities, and the list goes on. Thing is, counties serve the American people in so many ways, keeping our communities healthy, vibrant, safe, and fiscally sound. That's why counties matter.
Hi there, I'm Patrick Priest, Executive Director at CIS, and I really enjoy coming every year to this conference because CIS, we are all about counties. We are owned by counties. We were formed by the AOC. This is a great occasion for us to meet everybody in one place and learn what's important to the counties all across Oregon.
It's the networking. I mean, we learn a lot about the different issues that counties deal with, but it's networking with other commissioners, getting ideas on how they handle situations that is the most helpful for me.
I love my job. It actually matters to me on a daily basis. I used to do a lot of charity, and, you know, in commissioning in Deschutes County, you can make a serious difference. Lots of things have happened since I've been in office, and I feel like it's important to represent the people. I grew up in Eastern Oregon, and I love the residents of Eastern Oregon. The architect of our first house actually had Doris Day as a dear friend and a client, and he would bring Doris Day up the mountains in Malibu to our house as it was being built.
This is my fourth conference at AOC. My favorite part is the fellowship with other commissioners and coming up with solutions with common situations and with commissioners from around the state to best serve our people. My favorite part about being a commissioner in Josephine County is the people that we work with. We live in the most beautiful place, but we have the most beautiful people. They are talented, artistic, caring. We have such a high level of philanthropy and just caring for our fellow citizens, and it's the best place in all of Oregon.
Hi, I'm Commissioner Martha Schrader from Clackamas County, Oregon. I'm the current president of the Association of Oregon Counties. Oh my goodness, I've been president for 1 year, but I've been a member of the Association of Oregon Counties since 2003. So one of the reasons I really wanted to be president and I've enjoyed it so much is because I get to know everybody across the state, all the commissioners, and I've been from one end of the state to the other, visiting with them, talking with them, and really getting an idea of how we differ, but more importantly, what our similarities are and what we can do with one another to move forward with good county government.
I've been coming to AOC now for 4 years. My favorite part of serving as commissioner is trying to bring positive effects for our community and our county.
This is my second year at AOC, and the camaraderie that I've found in my Eastern Oregon partners and just the camaraderie of AOC has really blessed my life.
My name is Court Boys, Curry County Commissioner. This is a collection of people, county commissioners, public officials, well attended from all over the state. You know, I have the privilege of working with a very diverse group of people, different ages, different backgrounds, different interests, but they're all teaming up to solve the problems of our county. And it's just really a pleasure to be able to be connected with and working with those people. And better days, good days ahead for our county and our citizens.
Hi, I'm Joe Tobolskis. This is my third AOC convention, and my favorite part is the networking with the people. And the breakout sessions are kind of good because it gives me something to focus on, a goal where I want the county to be in 5 years when my term is up.
Hi, I'm Tillamook County Commissioner Dave Yamamoto. Our county college class was probably the best county college class ever at AOC. It was the largest at over 33 members. When you look at the legislature and the power that the major metropolitan areas have, the rural counties are oftentimes left out of those conversations. AOC really does a terrific job of representing rural counties and rural interests, and we wouldn't have the impact that we do in Oregon without AOC.
My name is Joe Burney, Lane County Commissioner from Springfield. My favorite part is eating good food. My second favorite part is meeting with other commissioners, seeing what they're thinking, comparing solutions to problems, learning how nonpartisan solutions really are, and getting ideas.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Derek DeGroot, Klamath County Commissioner. And so I'm running for second vice president of the Association of Oregon Counties. I believe that our association is perfectly poised to solve problems and bring solutions to Oregon politics and communicate with the legislature about the diversity of Oregon.
I'm Jay Bozovich, and I'm a Lane County Commissioner. And so I've been a commissioner for about 8 years and 11 months. And my favorite part about being a commissioner is this job is different every day.
Hi, my name is Alex Tardiff, and I'm a commissioner for Columbia County and currently serving as AOC treasurer in my second year. And the thing I enjoy most about AOC and being the treasurer is the ability to bring 36 counties together to build a state vision to move our state forward into the future while building a livable, workable community that we all want to enjoy.
One of the things I really appreciate about our entire region is that we embrace who we are, and I think that's what unifies us. Once the timber and fishing industries collapsed, it took us a long time to get back on our feet. People didn't quite grasp the idea that once these jobs left, they weren't going to get other family wage jobs, and it crippled us.
Things were getting really dire. So we just saw that this was an opportunity to maybe look at that public land a little differently and how it could bring more dollars into our region.
The Wild Rivers Coast is so unique because there are more wild and scenic rivers here than anywhere else in the lower 48 states. The scenic beauty is just amazing. There's so many different places to go, from the national forest down to the protected ocean, and it's just a really special place.
I guess I didn't really know how special it was, though, until I moved away to Portland and came back and saw all the potential here.
We're uncrowded, we're unspoiled, and we're a little difficult to get to, but my God, once you come here, you fall in love.
We just thought if we could pull people to come into this Wild Rivers Coast and stay longer and explore a little farther into our backcountry, there was a lot of opportunities for them to experience.
I think our whole future is at stake here. This area is ready to go. We just need to give it a little kick in the butt.
I'm going to be honest, when the World Tourism Studio came here, I was skeptical because I didn't see far enough ahead that we actually could collaborate regionally. And I'm pleasantly surprised. It's been amazing.
The Rural Tourism Studios was the first time we were able to come together as a region to talk about the future of our economy.
If we can have a strong tourism economy in this area, it's going to benefit the whole community.
We have to rely on ourselves, and I think through this program, it sort of opened our eyes to what we could do when we work together. Community leaders really focused on three areas: outdoor recreation, food and agricultural tourism, and really building community relationships.
In our area, a lot of the food that's grown all gets shipped away. And so now we're realizing that we can capture some of that local food that's grown here. The Eat Fresh and Local Action Team has hosted a series of networking events bringing together the area growers with the area vendors so that we could have more local food available to the visitors to our area. And now we're seeing more local food in our grocery stores, in our restaurants, and we have a new local food co-op.
We created a farm trail from Bandon to Port Orford. We did 9 U-Pick farms, and it just gained traction, and people loved it.
Langlois is less than 500 people. It's very small. So we have to bring in tourists. And being on the farm trail, even though it's just beginning, has really helped do that. We really want to make it a destination for anybody. My mom and I began Dragonfly Farm just 3 years ago. When I found out that I could grow a seed and turn that into food, it was like, oh my gosh, why wouldn't you do this? I just quit my day job and I just signed the paper to be an official co-owner of the farm. This is what I want to do for the rest of my life and grow with the community.
Out of the Outdoor Recreation Action Team, we came up with a series of maps that show where the best places to go recreate are. We know where we're going to send people now, and we got a great map that shows all the best places to go see.
For us to get a mapping project done to this extent is pretty impressive. We're patting ourselves on the back. I don't know anybody else is, but we're doing it.
From that, we decided that there was some places that needed help. So we came up with a mountain bike plan, and we also worked on designating a state scenic bikeway. The Outdoor Recreation Action Team was also looking at how we can make scuba diving better in this area. So we came up with the idea for a scuba fill station. So now people that want to come and dive in this area, they can dive for multiple days because they can get their tanks filled up again. When I started the Rural Tourism Studio, my business, South Coast Tours, was really small. And now we've grown to about 5 or 6 guides, and we're doing tours all over from Brookings all the way up to Coos Bay.
Overall, tourism is on the rise here. We've had a bang up last 2 years, and it's like a breath of fresh air down here.
My hope for the area is that we still keep that sense of place.
Loving a place to death is a big concern that I have, and it's a balance. We're going to promote tourism, but we want to do it in a sustainable way. One of the biggest reasons that this area has been so successful since the tourism studio is the people that are involved. We have a lot of great, motivated, smart people who understand the need to promote tourism in the right way. And it's really all about the people.
When you live in a rural community like we do, from Bandon down to Brookings, and you're strapped for cash, relationships are crucial.
As a community, I think you need to come together and find out what your mission and goals are collectively. Then you can work into smaller groups, knowing that you have the backing of the whole community behind you.
As long as everybody's just super excited about it and passionate about what they're doing and they can work together, then anything's possible.
Own what you have and don't try to be something that you're not. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna take a long time. So roll up your sleeves and just dig in with an open mind.
Everything starts out small. The things that hurt us, they all start from somewhere. The words we say, the things we do, they can grow into something else. What was small and innocent can become big and sometimes scary. All it takes is one comment, one picture, one video for something to catch fire. But a big problem doesn't need a big response. Not at first. Even if we don't know what to say, the eye emoji can be that first step we take. Let's all pledge to take that first small step together and change the world in a big way. I'm a witness, and so are you.
Roadway departure fatalities are a serious and often preventable problem in the United States. The Federal Highway Administration reports that 54% of all highway fatalities are caused by drivers leaving their lane of travel. The Oregon Department of Transportation is taking a proactive approach to reduce this kind of tragedy by implementing a centerline and shoulder rumble strip program.
Rumble strips are one of the most low-cost, cost-effective countermeasures that we can apply across the system.
Rumble strips are grooved patterns on the roadway that make a rumbling sound and a physical vibration, immediately warning inattentive drivers that they're leaving their driving lane. Rumble strips allow drivers to self-correct and avoid an accident.
About 67% of fatal crashes in Oregon are road departure crashes, which are a vehicle can leave the lane to the right and hit a ditch or a rock or a tree, something like that, or cross over the center line to the left and get in a head-on collision or a sideswipe meeting type crash.
Over an 8-year period, ODOT engineers studied segments of 16 different highways and concluded that rumble strips are highly effective at reducing lane departures.
We did a before and after crash analysis to find that we have reduced head-on fatalities by 40% with the installation of centerline rumble strips.
We've been trying to find a way to deal with a problem that seems to be increasing over the last 10 or 15 years with our drivers, and that's distracted driving. And there's a lot of things that cause distracted driving. All these distractions are things that make people take their attention away from where it should be.
Comparisons between other available safety features like guardrail and concrete barriers show that shoulder and centerline rumble strips are the most cost-effective safety treatment available.
We're finding that those are very effective in trying to make sure that when you do make that mistake, it's not the last mistake you make. They help bring your attention back to the driving task and bring you back to where you should be, focusing on being in the middle of your lane and being safe.
ODOT makes a conscious effort to use a bike-friendly rumble strip design where possible and installs 12-foot bike gaps every 48 feet of rumble strip. ODOT understands that rumble strips create a noise that can be disruptive for people who live near rural highways, and we're trying to address these concerns with different approaches.
For the noise, we're looking at some new designs. We're hoping that the new design rumble strip will be just as effective at saving people from making an error and much quieter, on the order of 10 times as quiet. And we are actually going to be installing our first full set of these style of rumble strips along 205 this summer.
So we recognize that noise is a concern, but one of the things I like to tell people is whenever you hear the sound of a rumble strip, it could be the sound of the life being saved of one of your loved ones.
Rumble strips are proven to save lives. The Oregon Department of Transportation is taking the lead in implementing the sound of safety. Thank you.
sign that doesn't have a rider on it, so we take our first step at this closest beach.
Harleyville that are seeing more than their share of curvy roads these days. Their job is to drive every state to highway in Region 1 several times. All this driving back and forth.
The old limits were set back in the 1930s and 40s and were changed very little until just recently. So now our limits are taking into account newer vehicles, a little bit more aggressive driving style. And so those limits are going up.
And going up in a big way. This is Eric Leeming, a traffic devices engineer with ODOT. He's driving an ordinary car with some extraordinary tech on board. A GPS device that records data as he maneuvers every curve in the road. Back at his office, Eric can upload the data recorded in the car, and special software determines exactly the right speed for every curve every time. Most speeds will increase by 5 to 10 miles per hour, but in some special cases, it's much higher.
The state has a deadline of 2019 from the Federal Highway Administration, but with 8,000 miles of roads to investigate and potentially thousands of signs to change, they're not wasting any time. They're getting out there right now.
Then we're going to the W113.
About 800 signs along this section.
That's a lot of signs.
It's a lot of signs. If it's a 35 mile an hour corner, you should be taking it at 35 miles an hour.
What draws you to the Oregon coast? Is it the green and blue surf on a brilliant sunny day, or angry boiling waves during a raging winter storm? Do you prefer quiet coves or powerful breakers churning the sand? How about sand castles? Do you come for the rising tide or the setting sun to marvel at whales gliding through the sea or flying in the sky? Reasons to travel the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway are as far-reaching as your imagination. This is a spectacular part of Oregon that traces the entire coastline along Highway 101, guiding you to the sea and away again, to coastal towns big and small, lowland marshes, and breathtaking overlooks. It's a long byway stretching from the mouth of the Columbia River to the California border, 363 miles in all, of some of the most unblemished, awe-inspiring seascapes you'll find anywhere. In addition to its designation as a scenic byway, Highway 101 in Oregon also has been selected as an all-American road. That means when you come here, you will experience one of only 31 roads considered to be the best of the best in America.
You know, when people come to the Oregon coast, they're really astonished how beautiful it is. And what separates it from many of the other places in North America that are coastal is how undeveloped it is. And that's because Oregon had a very far-sighted land use program back in the 1970s. We have all these wonderful state parks along the scenic byway that are perfect places to stop and enjoy nature in a relatively unspoiled way.
From the north, you begin in Astoria, the first permanent European settlement in the Pacific Northwest. It's a genuine maritime community with ship traffic from around the world seeking harbor up the Columbia. The official State Maritime Museum of Oregon sits here on the river. Beautiful Victorian houses dot the hillside. And standing 600 feet above sea level is the 125-foot Astoria Column, It features a hand-painted spiral frieze that would stretch over 500 feet if unwound. Heading south, you'll find the community of Seaside, a popular vacation spot that offers miles of public beaches, an oceanfront promenade, and a downtown core packed with restaurants, shops, and even a beach-type arcade. Cannon Beach is home to one of Oregon's most photographed natural wonders, Haystack Rock. Get your shots from the beach, or take a short drive up to Ecola State Park and look down on this 235-foot work of art. The picturesque small town is filled with art galleries, shops, and cafes. Ready for more? 10 miles to the south, this is the view from Cape Falcon. You're 700 feet above the Pacific. Here, the Pacific Coast Byway has been carved out of Neocone Mountain and held in place by stone walls built in the 1930s by craftsmen in the Civilian Conservation Corps. Upon descending the mountain, the highway drifts inward around Tillamook Bay to Tillamook, the unofficial dairy capital of Oregon. The verdant valley of dairy farms in this area produces 25 million gallons of milk annually. Much of that is processed into natural cheddar cheese. And near more than 800 miles of navigable waters, Tillamook is a crossroads for North Coast recreation. From here, you owe it to yourself to veer off Highway 101 to explore the Three Capes Scenic Loop. This drive places you right at the beach, beginning with Cape Mears, home to the shortest lighthouse in Oregon. 9 lighthouses stand sentinel along Oregon's coastline. They're monuments to our maritime heritage, towering links to the past, and as much a part of the rugged Oregon coastal landscape as any offshore monolith. The Cape Mears Lighthouse was first illuminated in 1890. Oregon's oldest lighthouse is at Cape Blanco, the westernmost point in the state. It was commissioned in 1870 to aid shipping generated by gold mining and the lumber industry. The 93-foot-high Yaquina Head Lighthouse is the tallest in Oregon. Today, its automated light continues to aid navigation at the entrance to Yaquina Bay. Many of the lighthouses are open to the public. Most happen to be excellent places to view nesting seabirds and offshore sea life. Tide pools, those rocky areas between high and low tides, support unique and diverse plants and animals. Vast amounts of colorful, otherworldly creatures wait to be discovered. But walk cautiously. These organisms are tough enough to withstand the pounding surf, but are utterly vulnerable to human activity. Wildlife and sea life abound on the coast.
There are 6 national wildlife refuges along the Oregon coast. The Pacific Coast Scenic Byway bisects these refuges or goes alongside them. It provides you the opportunity to see a wide variety of abundant wildlife, including seabirds, seals and sea lions, deer and elk, and many other wildlife.
Cape Kiwanda lies at the southern end of the Three Capes Scenic Loop near the town of Pacific City. Here you'll find a second Haystack Rock on the byway. Hike up the dune to marvel at stunning views of sandstone formations as they turn yellow, gold, or even red in the changing sunlight. If your timing is right, you'll spot one or two of the dory fleet sprint onto the beach after a day of fishing. How's this for a dinner setting? Restaurants along the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway accommodate just about any taste. Many serve an ocean view with every meal. Up and down the coast, you'll find seafood, of course, but don't limit yourself just because you're by the water. The Central Coast begins around Lincoln City, which is one of the larger communities on the byway. It has a reputation for being windy and was recognized by Kite Lines magazine as the best place to fly a kite in North America. It was incorporated from several small towns, and as a result, offers a sandy beach that is 7.5 miles long. A number of small state parks lie nestled along the ocean between Lincoln City and Newport. Stop, get out of your car, and take in the commanding views that are there, right next to your All-American Road. Depot Bay boasts the world's smallest navigable harbor, 6 square acres in all. A seawall runs the length of the downtown, so everywhere you go, you're rewarded with a dramatic view of the Pacific. It's considered Oregon's whale-watching capital, with thousands making their way past Oregon each fall and spring. Fishing and whale-watching excursions regularly set sail from this little harbor. Leaving Depot Bay, you'll soon find yourself at Cape Foulweather, a basalt outcropping that looms 500 feet above the water. It was here, in 1778, British Captain James Cook first sighted the mainland of North America on the Pacific coast. A fierce storm that almost put an end to his expedition earned this rugged stretch of coastline its name. Coastal weather can change by the hour. You will find a lot of wet days, but rain can become blue sky with white clouds in an afternoon. Mist kissing the headlands burns away, or storms can last for days. Some people come for those storms. Whether you find sunbursts of happiness or cloud cover like a quilt, there's always a reason to come back. Like Lincoln City, Newport is one of the larger towns on the byway. The historic bayfront on the north side of Yaquina Bay hosts one of Oregon's largest commercial fishing fleets. It has a busy, genuine working waterfront feel, with fish plants and boats coming and going from as far away as Alaska. On the south side of the bay is the Oregon Coast Aquarium. Share waters beneath the ocean with sharks and rays. And don't miss the sea otters at mealtime.
Now, all four of our otters were rescued otters. They were found out in the wild.
For the next 50 miles, your trip along Highway 101 hugs the coast. Many more state parks offer opportunities to stop and take in outstanding vistas, crashing waves, and offshore rock formations. Two small towns of note are Waldport and Yahats. Waldport sits on Alsea Bay, where fishing, clamming, and crabbing are popular. The 40-mile stretch south of Waldport marks steep headlands, jagged volcanic outcrops, and jaw-dropping scenery, the rugged edge of the Oregon coast. Yahats is a quiet, unhurried artist town just a couple of miles north of Cape Perpetua. Drive to the top of this bluff, and you'll be 800 feet above the water. On a clear day, you can see 70 miles of Oregon coastline. Drive past Hasita Head Lighthouse to the Sea Lion Caves. A quick elevator ride 200 feet down puts you in America's largest sea cave, the year-round home of wild stellar sea lions. Rugged cliffs give way to graceful beaches as you approach Florence. In the spring, be on the lookout for wild rhododendrons along the roadsides. Similar to Newport, you'll find an historic Old Town commercial district along the Siuslaw River. Florence is the gateway to the Oregon Dunes National Recreation Area. A 47-mile sandbox of wind-sculpted sand dunes towering 500 feet above sea level. These are the largest expanse of coastal sand dunes in North America. Reedsport is at the center of the Oregon Dunes. But you can do more than ride a dune buggy or motorcycle. A short 3 miles east of town on Highway 38, more than 100 Roosevelt elk reside at the Dean Creek Elk Viewing Area. Early mornings or just before dusk are the best times to photograph the herd. Paying homage to Oregon's timber heritage, Reedsport hosts an annual chainsaw sculpting championship, a time to watch three-dimensional artwork come to life right before your eyes. Mountains of sand continue at Winchester Bay. You'll also find an active marina here. It's a great place to try your hand at crabbing or take a charter for salmon or bottom fishing. The dunes end and you enter the coast's largest urban area at Coos Bay. It has the deepest natural harbor between Seattle and San Francisco. Foreign vessels sail under the massive McCullough Bridge. You may have noticed, dotted along the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway, are many beautiful and iconic bridges. The Megler Bridge in Astoria, Yaquina Bay Bridge in Newport, Alsea Bay Bridge in Waldport, Siuslaw River Bridge in Florence, and the magnificent McCullough Bridge in Coos Bay are works of art in their own right. Charleston is slightly off the byway at the mouth of the bay. It was once an old waterfront fishing village and has become a commercial and sport fishing center. From here, the Charleston to Bandon tour route offers another side trip off the byway. It's a wonderful way to explore a variety of natural Pacific Coast beauty in a number of settings: beaches, vistas, gardens, and more. Giant sea stacks, a tiny lighthouse, and an old town await you in Bandon. Do you like to golf? This remote area on the Oregon coast has not one, but three of the most stunning and challenging golf courses in the world. As you drive south of town, look for brilliant red bogs in the fall. You're passing through the cranberry capital of Oregon. After a trek through forests and farmlands, you'll reach Port Orford. The wild coast has begun.
You're in the most westerly city in the continental United States, and you've reached some of the most awesome scenery on the byway. Here you can watch a fishing fleet launched by crane in one of only six dolly ports in the world. Port Orford covers less than 2 square miles. It's similar to many communities that call this all-American road home. Small in size, still with a lot to offer. Like Manzanita, with a vibrant business district and beautiful setting at the base of Neocone Mountain. You can board a fishing charter out of Garibaldi, swim in freshwater lakes near Dune City, catch world-class windsurfing at Pistol River. There's little development from Port Orford to Gold Beach, outlet for the renowned Rogue River. Feel like going for a ride? Jet boat excursions run from May into October up this wild and scenic river. Or maybe a midday walk on an uncrowded beach is more your speed. The last dozen miles of the Pacific Coast Byway leading into Brookings save some of the best for last. Treat yourself to frequent stops along the Samuel H. Boardman Scenic Corridor. Short hikes reward you with the best views in this shining stretch of coastline. Walk, relax, and be amazed along the coves in the crashing surf. The world's northernmost redwood grove is 8 miles from the mouth of the Chetco River in Brookings. So, you've toured nature's finest art museum. You've dined elegantly, hung out with sea lions, unwound like you wish you could every day. What else is there to do? Step back in history near Astoria. Ride a horse along the waves near Florence. Pet a baby tiger near Bandon. Hike a trail, sample gourmet cheese, eat fresh caught crab, watch a sunset.
When you come to the Oregon coast and walk on the beaches or go to the headlands and go to the small coastal towns, you really can commune with nature and you don't have huge numbers of people, but you're also able to take in one of America's last great unspoiled seascapes.
So what draws you to the Oregon coast? What favorite places lure you back again and again? Each visit is different. The ocean, the sky, the light, and the experience always continue to amaze. Shouldn't you be there?
Why do counties matter? Simple. Counties provide the services we all depend on. If you're concerned about crime, get a regular flu shot, drive to work, take public transportation, or experience a natural disaster in your community, chances are you benefit from county services. That's why counties matter. With America's system of federalism, counties are a key level of government, serving the people directly. So, do you vote? Had a recent hospital stay? Know someone in a nursing home? More reasons why counties matter. There are 3,069 counties across the country, with populations big and small. Most of us live and work in one. Even the nation.
Thanks, JJ. Okay, we came out of, or coming out of executive session, January 20th, 2021. We've asked staff to proceed as directed, and we have, going back into regular session, we have one housekeeping item to complete. Director Rickert?
It occurred to me a couple hours ago that with mid-year budget reviews, I was planning on doing that on the 3rd, but that it probably doesn't work well to coincide with a regular business meeting. So I wanted to get some direction from the board on how to proceed with that. We can essentially cancel their regular business meeting and hold mid-year budget review, or we could...
How much time do you need, may I ask?
I've never been through this before. I don't really know. I've looked at... Well, I don't think so. I've looked back through the agendas for last year, and every director comes in and presents their portion of the budget. I think that they take about 15 minutes, but it does depend on how many funds that they are accountable for.
What, well, that's a good catch, first of all. What, we don't have anything really on the agenda for the third right now. In the
There's nothing on the agenda.
But we're probably going to have a workshop on the third.
And we can keep that.
So you're recommending for us to consider just going ahead and have the budget reviews schedule. I didn't know it was for all the departments. I didn't catch that. I'm sorry. So no, that would be a minimum of probably 3 hours.
Probably, okay? Yes.
Yeah. And that's fine. That's okay. Good. That's good business, in my opinion. So if we started that at 9, Director Rickard, and we could presumably be done by noon.
Yes, and we have talked to JJ, called Brad Alcorn, and he can do it that day, and that time frame works for him as well.
Well, see, we're only going to have one budget committee member of three there.
There'll be Brad Alcorn and the three of you, which, as far as I understand, does constitute a quorum for that.
Four-legged table, huh?
Yes.
I'm just thinking out loud here. That would put us to the 17th, so that is a full month for a general meeting. I'm a little bit nervous about that. I really wanted to stay, and I think the board wanted to stay with that process of the first and third Wednesdays of each month. So I'm just a little bit of a quandary here if we would want to try and have just a short meeting that day with just the at least keep the schedule open for possible bare necessities that you're going to need to bring before the board. Commissioner Pass, your thoughts, please.
Well, I was just thinking, I think what we did last year, if I remember, but I'm not sure, JJ probably snap knows right away. But we did it, I thought we did a separate day. It was like Tuesday, the day before our normal meeting, or on a Monday we did it, our budget session meeting, and then we still had our normal meeting.
How about
if we do it on like Tuesday, do the budget report meeting, you know, and then do our regular meeting.
How about if we do this? How about if we hold the calendar open for a regular meeting on the 3rd and do an afternoon budget review process and don't do the workshop? We can put, it's much easier, I think, to postpone the workshop than it is a general meeting. Again, with COVID and everything else we're dealing with, stuff comes up and we want to just kind of hold the calendar open.
Yeah, that's okay with me.
So we'll just plan on a workshop and a regular meeting on the 17th, which is the third Wednesday, and we'll stay with the general meeting on the 3rd and hold that whole afternoon open, and we'll be here. And does that give you enough time?
Yes, that should.
Okay, and to notify all your department heads, and you know, it usually takes about 20-30 minutes for each one.
Yeah, I believe they had a week last year, so they have 2 weeks this year.
Okay. Commissioner Pash?
JJ was like,
hi.
We need four for a quorum. Brad Alcorn's the quorum. He can only make it Wednesday morning, 9 to noon, because he's got the canine training.
Okay.
That is what we were talking about, though, right? Holding 9 to noon budget meeting, canceling the workshop, and doing general meeting.
We can do a general meeting in the afternoon.
In the afternoon.
No reason we can't.
Yep.
It'd be a little unorthodox. JJ, that'll work for you?
Of course.
Okay, so that's tentative on the schedule for budget review on the 3rd of February and general meeting if needed. We could even throw in a workshop if we had one quick item after that. That would be that tough to post in.
Okay. Well, so let's see how many items we get for the general meeting.
Okay.
And that's something else to consider is how many items. Let's say we get really busy, how many items we actually allow on the agenda for the regular meeting, because we're going to be, the regular meeting won't start till at least 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
Agreed. So we'll be ready to work. Go for it. Commissioner Pass, did you have something else?
No, sir.
Commissioner Herzog?
No, sir.
For the good of the order, this general meeting is now closed. See you on the 3rd, everybody.